And welcome to the first meeting in 2024 of the Finance and Public Administration Committee. I'd like to wish you all a happy new year. I'd also like to congratulate committee member Liz Smith on the award of her well-deserved CBE in the New Year's Honours List. We have a single item on our agenda which involves taking evidence on the Scottish Budget 2024-2025 from two panels of witnesses. First, we will hear from Joao Souza, Deputy Director, Fraser Valder Institute, Chris Burt, Associate Director for Scotland of the Joseph Rowntree Foundation, and Professor David Bell, Professor of Economics, University of Stirling. I welcome you all to the meeting and thank you for your written submissions. We'll move straight to questions. And I'd like to ask, Well, first of all, I should say that if I ask a question, I might ask an individual member of the panel. Others can chip in, or it could be to all members of the panel. So we'll kind of circuit and see, so to speak, as we move forward. First one I was going to say is that the Scottish Government said that it would actually prioritise spending in terms of three missions: equality, the tackling of poverty and protecting people from harm, opportunity, a fair, green and growing economy, and community, prioritising our public services. So in terms of this year's ongoing budget, I'm just wondering how you think the Scottish Government is doing. And I think we'll start with Mr Burt.
Thanks, Convener. Well, I think I'll focus, if I may, first on the poverty issue. And as reflected in my written submission, I found the budget very disappointing in that regard. While there was welcome protection for some of the schemes which the Scottish Government already have in place, which I've waxed lyrical about many times, about the Scottish Child Payment, etc., I don't see anything else in the budget which will significantly reduce poverty. And I think there is a significant risk with the huge cuts to funding for affordable housing in particular, that this budget could lead to a rise in poverty as well. And I think there aren't that many budgets left before the Scottish Parliament's child poverty reduction targets have to be met in 2030-31. Those were unanimously set by every party in this Parliament. And I think every budget that ticks by until that time leaves children in this country in poverty. So I am concerned by this budget. And I think the Scottish Government could certainly have done more around poverty.
Okay, I mean, obviously I've read your submission in some detail, and I notice it doesn't actually set any context of where we actually are in terms of the finances and the economics of where the Scottish Government finds itself. So you kind of, you do talk in your report about the need to, for example, increase the Scottish Child Payment to £30. And you talk about reversing the reduction in the affordable housing supply budget, which you say you refer to the reduction as being brutal. How would you do that then, given the fact that the Scottish Government has got a £484 million cut in its capital budget next year, and is already in the resource budget has been increased by only 2.6%. So, for example, the Scottish Child Payment has been increased by 6.7%, in line with the UK's increases in benefits. So, how would you square that circle?
I think on the revenue side, look, ultimately, government is about choices. There was lots. The Scottish Government's financial pressures are not invented; they are real. I get that. But some of that is about, of course, the austerity which the Scottish Government has faced over the last 10 years or so, but also about the choices that it's made. In some ways, very positive choices. Choices to extend childcare provision, things like the Scottish Child Payment, the reforms to adult disability payments. These put pressure on the budget, absolutely. But we've heard a lot about the hard choices that the Scottish Government's had to make in this, yet we had things like the freeze to council tax, which is, you know, they've had to put aside £140 million to finance on the revenue side to cause that. The rise in the Scottish Child Payment would have easily been covered by that and could have been much more directly targeted at poverty reduction. I think that's part of my concern, is that I get that we are in constrained financial circumstances, absolutely. So that means we then need to focus and look with precision at how we target additional funding on poverty reduction. I think that's what was lacking.
That's a valid point. That's a choice that you would make. You would have preferred to that the money was being spent in the council tax freeze be spent on child poverty. And that's maybe an issue that myself or one of my colleagues will put to the Cabinet Secretary. But on the capital front, you know, how you're saying that we should reverse the reduction to the cut in affordable housing. How do you do that in the context of a £484 million reduction in capital?
Look, capital reduction, capital spending is too low in the UK as a whole, and that is reflected in the spending in Scotland. Again, I get that. Government have to make choices about how they prioritise investment. This government also has targets set by this Parliament to reduce child poverty.
A bit of that, but I mean, it's easy to come along and say you should spend this amount on that or that amount on this. But if you're actually using words like brutal reductions in council, in housing budgets and it should be reversed, I think it's incumbent to say how it can be reversed. What should the Scottish Government not spend capital on in order to fund the housing that you believe should be prioritised?
Well, I think it is brutal in the context of the housing situation that we have in the country. I think, as I say, we need to focus the capital budget on poverty reduction. Housing is a way of doing that. Again, it's entirely up to the Scottish Government to how it prioritises the capital budget as a whole. But when we look at, say, the mix of our targets to reduce poverty and our climate reduction targets, I think it's a reasonable question for this Parliament to ask of the government.
It's a reasonable question, but it's also a reasonable question to say where would the money come from to reverse that reduction? Where else in this budget? Because we are scrutinising the Scottish budget, and I think the point you've made about the council tax is a valid one. You know, we may agree or disagree on that, but on capital, I'm not seeing anything really here. All you're saying is, we should reverse that cut. Well, yeah, maybe we should, but where should the money come from to do that?
Well, I was
the
just
point
about
making from within the Scottish Government's capital budget. Should it reduce money? For example, it's increased the capital budget for the police by 12.4%. Should it not have done that? As an example, our Scottish Fire and Rescue Service has increased its capital budget. Should those have not been done? How should the Scottish Government respond to this polemic, really, to be honest?
Well, I was about to give you an example. I think when we look at poverty reduction, we will look at our climate reduction targets. You know, capital investment, say, in roads infrastructure. Is that the right priority at this current time compared to people who, you know, we see increases in rough sleeping in our country? The way to fix that is to increase the supply of affordable housing, amongst other things. So I think you're right to push me on that, Convener, but frankly, these are the priorities that the Scottish Government have set themselves. It's up to them to defend them.
Right, OK, fair enough. So what you're basically saying is you maybe take the money from the roads budget. Would that be correct in saying that?
As I say, it is for the Scottish Government to balance their capital budget, but my priorities would be for poverty reduction.
OK. Professor Bell, what's your view on the three missions?
Well, I agree with what a lot of Chris has said. On the poverty reduction, the Scottish Government has made a decision around child payment. For all of the social security payments, what matters is the net position. That is how much Scotland is spending on the one hand versus how much it gets in compensation from the UK government on the other, the block grant adjustment in relation to social security. Now, it was known for some time that because there's no comparator to the child payment south of the border, that would be an additional pressure on the social security budget. And there's also a question of how whether Scotland is dealing somewhat differently with disability payments. Nevertheless, all of that was known, and it's a decision. You know, I'm not saying that's the wrong way to take policy, but the consequence is that the net position as far as Social Security is concerned is already negative and is going to continue to, that negativity is going to continue to increase to around $1 billion, I think, in 27-28. Now, that means, you know, in the great scheme of things, that tough decisions have to be made. And we knew that was going to be the position. We've known it for some time. And to take account of that, really, the Scottish Government has to say, well, times are tough. Some other budgets have to be trimmed in relation to that. Now, that's really about the resource budget. The capital budget, I think, arguably has had what I'm saying is that as far as the resource budget was concerned, there were signals already there that changes would have to be made. With the capital budget, I think it's reasonable to argue that a lot of it was a surprise stemming from the autumn statement, and therefore very rapid adjustments had to be made. And some of them could reasonably be described as brutal, but there was, in the circumstances, not that much in terms of choice for the Scottish Government.
Yeah, I mean, basically you've said in your paper, you know, that Scotland is now spending £1,092 million a year in benefits and welfare payments over and above what was effectively devolved. And Spicer said by 2028-29, this will rise to £1,502 million in current projections. So how sustainable do you feel that is?
Well, it's sustainable if you're willing to say then these other programmes are going to have to be cut. And you have to be upfront, it seems to me, politically, to say what it is that you're going to cut in order to fund these additional social security payments. There's no easy way around that, seems to me.
Okay. Now, in terms of capital, what you've said is, David, you've said that low investment is acknowledged to be one of the key impediments to growth, both at the Scottish and UK levels. Public sector investment helps de-risk private investment, therefore cutting public investment will adversely affect overall levels of investment in the Scottish economy and consequently growth. So what do you feel the long-term implications for Scotland are of the reduction in capital?
I don't think they're good. I think the Resolution Foundation have fairly convincingly shown that the UK in general underinvests in public infrastructure. They are arguing that should rise to 3% of GDP as a kind of guiding principle going forward. And effectively, you know, the capital budget, as far as Scotland is concerned, really, it doesn't have a huge amount of control over that, unless it chooses to make decisions about switching resource funding, which it can do. Again, within very tight budget parameters, those are going to be very difficult decisions. It seems to me that the evidence from independent sources suggests that the UK and Scottish government should be increasing spending on capital infrastructure publicly. And as I said the last time I appeared here, that can de-risk private sector investment. And we're in a situation where public sector investment in terms of going further into debt is becoming more and more difficult. But for the Scottish government going forward, thinking about future generations, not just the current generation, unless we increase our capital spend above the fairly paltry levels that we've got at the moment, it seems to me that that is not going to be good for incomes. I'm not making a point about how they're spread, but income in general will not increase unless you have the infrastructure to support business going about its activities.
Okay, and then also in your paper you talked a lot about taxation, and you basically talk about the Scottish Government's decision actually to increase taxation on those who are higher earners. So, for example, what you've said is that when you actually look at those earning £100,000 to £125,000 a year, the marginal rate is probably the highest of any OECD country. It's 69.5%. For example, the highest in Denmark is 55.5%, France 42.2%, and Sweden 55.2%. What do you believe the impact of that, of those high rates would be? Are positive, negative, or a mix of the two?
So, I described the Scottish income tax structure as a not really progressive, more disjointed. And this is due to the interaction of national insurance, the personal allowance, and income tax rates. And really, the first thing to say is that the UK as a whole should have addressed the kind of bizarre ways that the rules around these different elements of the overall tax structure don't integrate well together. And the particular case is the one between 100 and 125. So you ask a well-qualified hospital doctor to take on additional responsibility and offer her an increase in salary from 100 to 125,000 to take on that additional responsibility, and they get to keep about 7,000 of that additional money. Now, would you do it? Is the question that that people will reasonably ask. Now, this is, we're talking at the top end of the income distribution here, but it is nevertheless true that the top end of the income distribution matters a lot as far as income tax revenues are concerned. They massively disproportionately contribute towards the total tax revenue. So whereas a lot of other taxes, impinge unfairly on poorer people, one couldn't say that about the way that the income tax structure works in Scotland. And of course, I think effectively your question is getting at the issue of the behavioural response. And that's very complicated. I talk about that in the paper, that there's the sort of response in terms of people not being willing to take the promotion, working less, and so on. There's the migration response, which is about people maybe not coming to Scotland, which is very difficult to calibrate. And then there's the third. And this is me going back to a point I've already made, that the third issue, which is around what matters as far as income tax is concerned, is not how much we're raising, but the net position as far as the block grant adjustment is concerned. Are we ahead or are we behind? And that involves a comparison between the growth in income tax revenues on both sides of the border. So, this is all quite complex and also really quite difficult to accurately get a handle on. But the Scottish Fiscal Commission have done quite a bit of work, and that's why they come out with the answer that you might mechanically expect to get about 180 million out of this, but you're only actually likely. That 180 is based on the assumption of no behavioural change. You're only likely to get about 80.
Yes, I mean, the figures actually, in your own paper, in actual fact, and they're backed up by Scottish Parliament Information Centre, is that for the highest rate, the over 125,140, they expect the mechanical rate, if you like, the mechanical income to be 56 million, but post-behavioural change, it's only 8 million.
Yeah.
and the amount of £75,000 up to £144 million raised on paper, but only £74 million in reality. Mm-hmm. Are these figures that you recognise, Joel?
Yes, they broadly reflect what the methodology is that the Scottish Fiscal Commission uses to cost this. I think I had mentioned before when I was giving evidence here that it's very uncertain whether that where things end up, but this is based on what is essentially the best available evidence, and it's something that they have transparently put out in their approach to forecasting income tax, and therefore it is the figures are slightly higher than we thought when we tried to cost it at the Fraser Valander Institute, in large part because the data that the Scottish Fiscal Commission has access to on real-time information turned out, which they used to calibrate their model, turned out to be stronger, and therefore that means that, you know, the whole of the income tax system raises a bit more than we thought before.
Okay, now I want to go back to the first question because you've not had an opportunity to really answer it. So it's with regard to this budget and whether it delivers in your view in terms of the missions that the Scottish Government has set itself.
So there's a number of you can see how some public services have been protected. For example, health is growing more strongly than other areas. You can see how social security has been prioritised, as the rest of the panelists have mentioned, and that has come at a cost. It is for the Scottish Government and the Scottish Parliament to assess whether that is a worthwhile cost or not. But definitely is a risk in terms of managing a budget that for the UK government would be what's called annually managed expenditure, and so we wouldn't have fixed limits, whereas the Scottish government's budget does have much more fixed limits, although there is some flex in terms of how much revenue it raises. I think a question could reasonably and fairly be asked as to whether some of the tax measures have been, as a whole, focused solely on equality. So, yes, people who earn more have been asked to pay more through income tax, but a lot of people who also live in quite valuable properties have not been asked to pay more council tax, and in fact they've been given relative to the consultation that was put out over the summer quite a big cut to what they might have expected to be paying. There's a whole other issue as to whether the council tax system itself is fit for purpose and whether there should be a revaluation on that, because there is an implicit tax break for people who live in desirable places now that weren't so desirable in 1991. And as a whole, there are some people who earn quite a lot will have benefited on net from the budget, and some other people who won't have. And there's also a differential effect on families or households with one or two earners, for example, who might have the same combined earnings but might have very different results from this due to the fact that income tax is levied on a personal basis, whereas council tax is levied on a household basis.
But when the Scottish Government has got so few levers, I mean, how easy is it to take into account, many children there are in a family and all this kind of stuff?
I'm not saying it is particularly easy, but that's why the decisions need to be taken on the considerations of who they're targeted at and whether they do fit with that intention of promoting equality. In terms of growth, I think I share the concern about low investment. I think that's been a problem for a long time. But it is not something that is very easy to see how the Scottish Government within its current framework can do loads about other than decide how to allocate the capital budget, because it is already using its borrowing powers quite a lot. It has had some additional flexibilities through the fiscal framework review, but they're not a lot, and they only change things at the margin. And so, I mean, it's in most years borrowed quite a lot of the allowed limit of around £450 million. So yeah, it's a difficult situation, and it's one that sadly does have potentially quite limiting effects in terms of economic growth going forward, because we know that investment is one of the main and capital per worker is one of the big drivers of economic growth in the long run.
Okay, David, you wanted to come in here?
No, just I didn't say anything much about opportunity, and I do think it's not really a great budget for as far as opportunity is concerned. Cuts to the enterprise agencies, which have already suffered fairly significant cuts, aren't really a good signal as far as inward investment is concerned. Surprisingly, Scotland's record as far as inward investment is concerned has kind of held up, but one of the UK government agencies has been collecting data on the net investment position, which is inward investment less outward investment, so disinvestment. And on that score, Scotland doesn't do, or the most recent data, Scotland doesn't do very well at all. And inward investment, again, is an area that for the UK, inward investors tend to set up businesses which have higher productivity per worker than the average, and that has been a big driver of economic growth in the past. And we do not see very significant inward investment projects coming to Scotland at the moment. Seems to me. Sorry, that was my...
That's fine. On the back of that, Chris, you've said in the second last paragraph of your own statement that, and I quote, economic growth will not solve poverty. Government decisions to facilitate poverty reduction will. But surely you need economic growth to generate the revenue in order to invest in anti-poverty programmes.
A strong economy, and potentially a growing economy, is absolutely vital to the health and the well-being of the nation as a whole. Completely. The point I'm making there is that economic growth alone does not guarantee a reduction in poverty. For example, we saw economic growth in the UK during the 1980s, but as we all know, poverty and inequality shot up over that period. So the type of growth that you see is crucial. So what I'm trying to do there is push, sometimes we do hear the argument is that, well, if we generate economic growth within the economy, we'll reduce poverty. We won't. We will generate revenues, hopefully, more to support government investment. Yes, so that does allow opportunities that we've seen in the past, things like the introduction of the tax credit system and stuff like that, which do reduce poverty, but those are government choices. They weren't as a result of economic growth. That's just the difference I'm trying to highlight.
Yeah, but all else being equal, economic growth is a positive thing. Would you agree?
Yeah.
Jill, what do you feel about economic growth in terms of poverty?
So I agree with a lot of what Chris said. It's not necessarily guaranteed that you will the economic growth reduces poverty. You know, relative poverty and income inequality can increase and does increase in some economic cycles, positive economic cycles. If you have more economic growth, you're more likely to have more resources to redistribute. So the choices become easier if you have a bigger pot from which to redistribute. And then it's for the government to decide who it wants to focus its resources on.
So in terms of that, this will be my last question, and others can ask as well, answer as well, sorry. Do you feel the Scottish Government has done enough to prioritise economic growth in this budget?
I wouldn't say that the budget was particularly focused on growth. There was a lot on the choices in a difficult financial situation. The Scottish budget itself the fact that the Scottish government has to balance its budget does mean that you end up in many cases running what is a pro-cyclical policy. That means that, you know, if your revenues aren't as strong as you might expect them to be, you might have to cut your spending to balance the budget, which is not necessarily a great position to be in, and is not how you would necessarily run a fiscal authority if you had the choice of how to design it. But those are kind of the constraints that the powers of the Scottish Government and the Scottish Parliament that they exist in. So,
okay, David.
I would just say that ostensibly it doesn't look like the budget particularly favours economic growth. I think there have been previous budgets that have been more pro-growth. However, it's kind of difficult, and I think here we need maybe the Scottish Government to concentrate more on arguing the case. For example, the increase in the health budget may itself help people, you know, get back to work. Disability payments that are being made through the Social Security budget may help people back into some form of employment, or contributing to the community in other ways. Remember, it is true, and I'm happy to acknowledge this, GDP doesn't measure the welfare of the community. There are lots of things which do good which aren't counted towards GDP. Nevertheless, it seems to me that the case for some of the extra spending, if it is to be linked to growth, where it's not clear that's the case, as in terms of the health spend, say, then we need a better case being made, and that would have to be based on more information than is currently being provided.
Chris, yeah, what do you feel? And I should also say, I mean, I know you've been critical of the Scottish Government not increasing child payment to Scottish child payment to £30. It's gone up obviously to £26.70, but both the SNP and Labour in their manifestos promised £20 by 2026, and it's already going to go up this year to £26.70. And inflation that's much higher than inflation has been over those years. So how do you feel about that, and indeed the issue of economic growth?
Yeah, I mean, I have said and will continue to say how important the Scottish Child Payment is, and I think it is a vindication of the power and the potential of this Parliament. That payment should reduce child poverty, other things being equal, you know, somewhere between 4 to 6%. That's lifting tens of thousands of children out of poverty. I think it's also worth reflecting, though, on the context within which that is made. We've heard, for example, from a family who said, oh, the child payment's brilliant because it means I put the heating on when the kids get home from school. Now, that's a good thing, obviously, but we shouldn't live in a country where people are making choices as to whether or not they're putting the heating on when their kids get back from school. So the child payment, and what David has talked about there, just about the kind of the reasoning and defence for this kind of additional spending. I mean, disability assistance spending is an interesting example, and I totally get where the Scottish Government might have some frustration in the kind of pressure which is coming on to them, because to a large part they are picking up a deficit which has been created by the policy of the UK government. So, for example, we know that a lot of the additional spending built into disability assistance payments is because Social Security Scotland have made the process more accessible in the hope that more people will take up what they are eligible for. Now, that's a good thing, but that's costing the Scottish Government a lot of money. And we have seen, you know, the SFC have talked about in their projections that they see the cost of living crisis contributing towards that increase. So I do think when we talk about given economic growth and the fundamentals of society, which I kind of come on to on the end of my submission, is that I do think we have one of the fundamental weaknesses in our economy in this country is levels of economic inactivity and levels of poverty amongst our population. You know, we did a bit of work with IPPR and Save the Children earlier last year, looked at levels of unemployment amongst people who experienced child poverty in their childhood, much higher in adulthood. So by not reducing poverty, we're creating economic weaknesses in our, within our society. So as Dave has alluded to, the kind of line between a pro-economic growth policy and a not pro-economic growth policy is often a lot more muddy than the debate would suggest.
Okay, thank you. I'm going to, excuse me, open up the session. First colleague to ask questions will be Michelle, to follow by John.
Good morning, panel, and thank you, convener. I've got a couple of areas I want to explore, but I want to go back to one of the principles that the convener was outlining in terms of the focus on a greener and growing economy. Now, we've asked quite a lot of questions thus far about growing, but I wanted to just get some views on the greener element of it, perhaps in particular the low focus on CapEx and the impact, therefore, on net zero goals and just transition. So can I just ask that as an open question? In other words, to what extent will this budget enable the greener element, and greener and growing, because obviously we've got supply chain considerations, and to what extent it won't? So perhaps Professor Bell, you'd like to go first.
If I was being honest, I would say that the although, as Chris has pointed out, that there are weaknesses in the argument that this has been a pro or a budget designed to alleviate poverty, I think that has been given a higher priority than the green aspects of the budget in this case. And that's partly driven by the capital budget, which the Scottish Government, just as in a sense, has had to deal with, but because a lot of the additional expenditure to move towards net zero is not resource spending, it's capital spending, there's also the question of things like biodiversity, nature restoration, and so on, and the picture there is less buoyant, let us say, than in other areas that we've already been discussing around social security and health and so on.
Dr. Souza?
So I think there's definitely been a couple of things that I've noticed that were cut or heavily reduced in the capital budget, as David mentioned, which include the Just Transition Fund, which is expected to be £50 million a year. It's been cut to £12 million, I think, for the coming year, and only for projects that are already ongoing, as far as I understand from the not very easy to follow description on the right hand side of a spreadsheet, seven rows down on the budget page. The Scottish Forestry Woodland Grants have been cut by a lot, and that was something that was kind of surprising, and was, again, just hard to tell what exactly the effect of that is going to be. But if you thought that was a priority last year, I can't see why that wouldn't be this year otherwise. And the other thing that I should note is kind of thinking about the link between skilling and green jobs in the future. One thing that I was particularly surprised by was the permanent cut that's been made to the Scottish Funding Council for first year university places and Institute for Fiscal Studies. And I think you might have had some evidence about this last month. Has talked about the fact that tuition is free in Scotland if you can get a place, but places are capped and they're not elsewhere in the UK for domiciled students. And this, I think there's no detail, as far as I can tell, on how many places are going to be, how much places are going to be reduced by, but you know it's about 5 or 6% in real terms the cut. So you'd expect that there might be a non-trivial number of places cut, and if we think that we would like people to train into, and I should say it's not just university places, because college places as well, funding for colleges has also been reduced. So you have to think about the fact that training people into higher skilled occupations for the future growing economy and on green jobs should be a priority. And there's a question of whether the choices revealed that to be the case or not.
Thank you for that. And I suspect my colleague Liz Smith will want to come in on that. I know it's an area of interest of her. But coming on to yourself, Chris, we know that a so-called just transition and the challenges of getting to net zero affects different socioeconomic groupings differently. Given the very real cuts to some of the areas we've mentioned around the ambition towards getting to net zero and enabling a just transition, do you have any specific concerns on how this will affect the people who are most in poverty or help push them into poverty over the longer term? Do you have any concerns about that? And if so, what are they?
Yeah, I mean, I think this ties back to my point on housing and on prioritisation. Like, as I think each of the panel reflect on, the capital budget is heavily constrained. So where we look at how we're making investments, we want to get the most targeted return for our investment. And frankly, new housing, which is very energy efficient, is a good outcome for all sorts of reasons. It helps contribute towards our climate targets. It's cheaper for the households involved. Mm-hmm. And I think, particularly, we will always face high heating costs in Scotland because of where we are in the world. But we know lots of families hopefully we will never see the sort of instability we've seen in the energy market over the last couple of years again. But we need to smooth off those bumps. We need to make energy costs much more predictable for people. And then in rural areas, we need to act quickly. To me, the opportunity to tackle fuel poverty in rural areas in this transition is such an obvious open goal for us to take on, and how we target energy efficiency measures and decarbonisation of heating within those, are particularly people who are either off-grid or relying on heating fuels. It just seems so obvious to me. So, yeah, I think there's that mix of new energy-efficient homes are a good outcome for all sorts of different outcomes, but also how we target fuel-poorer households and in particular ways within rural areas as well, I think is important.
Thank you. And I wanted to lead on to something else then. Given that, Professor Bell, were you surprised by the £60 million cut to the funding for the Scottish National Investment Bank? And, I mean, obviously, we all want to get its FCA rather regulation so it can crowd in other sources of funding. We understand that. But what's your view on that £60 million cut and how that might impact on our net zero ambitions and indeed in other areas?
I guess this touches on the point that I made earlier and also in my previous appearance at the committee around de-risking and the role that something like the Scottish National Investment Bank can play because it can't push us directly towards net zero. We need to have private sector investment. And it can support that kind of investment with its directive that it has to support investments in that kind of area. So I suspect this will make some perhaps more speculative investments, perhaps around new technologies that might accelerate the move towards net zero. I think it may slow down these kinds of investments, and it's difficult. Perhaps there are alternative funding mechanisms, but thus far the Scottish National Investment Bank seems to be the one institution that's very clearly aimed at this particular issue.
Mm-hmm. I just wanted to move on to one other area, although I appreciate that both the other panellists might have further comments. Were you surprised, and I perhaps come to you, Dr. Sousa, about the allegation of the money off ScotWind to resource expenditure? And would you ordinarily expect fiscal rules to be applied to this money by government? I'd appreciate your views on that.
I have to confess that I don't. I haven't looked at that in detail, so okay. I would rather not comment on something that...
Okay. Professor Bella.
Well, if you think of the ScotWind money as a sort of equivalent to your sovereign wealth fund, then you know what you should do with your sovereign wealth fund is use it to support future generations, because it's a sort of one-off payment, and to be equitable, you should spread it not just on the generation that has been lucky enough to have the revenue gathered, so to speak. But it seems like, as with oil, there seems within the British Isles to be a willingness not to think in those more longer-term perspectives.
So you would expect fiscal rules to be applied to that in effect?
I would have thought that would be advisable.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Convener.
Okay, thank you. John, to be followed by Michael.
Thanks very much, Convener. Maybe I could start with yourself, Dr. Sousa. You say in your report, you comment on the fact that the SFC is quite optimistic about Scottish earnings growth, more optimistic than OBR had been. Are you convinced by their arguments? Do you think that is convincing?
So there is definitely data regarding 21-22 and 22-23 that gives some, I think those are the criteria, that gives some indication that that earnings in Scotland were growing more quickly. The question is then, is that something that will be sustained? And obviously they have anchored their judgment on the basis of the pre-2015-16 average and some catch-up of Scottish earnings to UK average earnings. I think it's a real risk, and it's a real risk, I think, for the 2026-27 budget, and it's something that it feels like it's a long time away. It's probably, it will be laid before the next election, but something that will happen after the next election. So it can feel like it's very far into the future. But actually, this kind of compound risks in terms of the reconciliations. I think there is a reasonable argument that there might be some catch-up of earnings growth, but it is also, in my view, a reasonable argument that if something hasn't happened on a sustained basis for 7 or 8 years, then it might not happen that quickly, and then there is a real risk that the Scottish Government could be facing a worse reconciliation than he might have anticipated back then.
Okay, Dr. Bell, Professor Bell, did you want to come?
So my paper showed that actually the April 2023 numbers on earnings showed Scotland growing faster than any other part of the UK. But there was a note attached to that was partly due to a public sector payments that had been made sort of in advance in Scotland. So settlements had been made in Scotland that hadn't been made in England particularly. So the question of, it'll be very interesting to see the April 2024 figures, which will give us the next accurate indication of where we are as far as earnings are concerned. Dr. Sousa has already alluded to this. The position as far as income tax is concerned obviously depends on earnings, and these generate income tax revenues over a period of time, and because we don't know until maybe 2 years later what the exact figure is, you have this issue of reconciliations which have to be made and can come as very unwelcome surprises. It's interesting to think
so,
about...
Sorry to interrupt you, but does that mean that... So if the SFC was over-optimistic by mistake or whatever, that could lead or would lead to a very negative reconciliation?
Sure. Absolutely. Yes. Absolutely. And that might come... Well, yes. You're then very dependent on the accuracy of the SFC forecast. So if you downgrade your view of that accuracy, you set aside funding or you put in place plans that should there be this very negative reconciliation, that's what you will do, and people need to be clear about that. One other point I would make, which is slightly it's not exactly what you asked for, but the possibility that there would be an income tax reduction in England in the next budget in March would actually increase potentially the behavioural effects, because the gaps would... I understand that the First Minister said there would be no change in income tax in Scotland. That would potentially increase the behavioural responses, but would also slow down the growth in income tax revenues in England relative to Scotland. So actually, the block grant adjustment would be smaller, and that would be advantageous to the Scottish budget. So there'd be a... You know, we can't exactly predict what the outcome would be, but because if that happened, the gaps in terms of income tax rates would be even greater than they already are.
Okay. Mr. Burt, I was going to come to you. I mean, if you want to comment on any of that, you can, but I was going to move on to the council tax freeze. I kind of picked up you weren't all that enthusiastic about it. I mean, is the council tax freeze aiming to achieve some target that you're aware of, or, you know, what is there anything good comes out of the council tax freeze?
That's a good question. Like, I get it. Like, the bills that everybody is facing are going up. You know, we all see it. You know, things like car insurance and stuff have shot through the roof. And so the idea of another bill, and council tax is often kind of totemic in these things, not going up, will be a relief for a lot of people. Don't get me wrong, that's absolutely the case. However, the difference that it makes for almost every household concerned depends, as Zhao has referred to, whether you take into account the potential changes to the bans, etc. The difference is fairly marginal. I think IPPR Scotland, I've sort of said that it wouldn't make any difference to poverty levels in Scotland. That seems right to me. But also, it's just the revenue foregone, which could have been used for something different. I mean, we've talked about the child payment as one of them. I mean, we've not talked about it yet, but we are still in the grips of a cost of living crisis. You know, I think Citizens Advice yesterday talked about 250,000 people in Scotland using warm banks. Warm banks just used to be indoors. And now we have to have a situation where communities, you know, which are brilliant, of communities coming together and providing safe and warm space. That's great. So I think it's just, it doesn't strike me as the right priority at this time, no.
Okay. I mean, can either of the others, if you want to, say, you know, what is the good thing that comes out of a council tax freeze?
I would agree with what Chris said. For the people who benefited from it, clearly they will get something out of it, whether that is then worth the total cost. And when you then think about the effect on council financing, because, and this is the point that we've been making ever since it was announced is that you need to consider what councils would have done otherwise to then say whether, you know, they've been fully compensated or not. And just based on previous years' behaviours, there are some councils, particularly some that deal with, you know, their rurality, meaning that they have higher costs on delivering some services, for example. So I think Orkney increased their council tax by 10% in the previous year. Now they're getting compensated for 5%. You know, it doesn't seem out of the realistic levels of possibility that they would have done the same this year or this coming year. So they won't be compensated for that. But some councils who might have increased it by less will gain from it. But then there's the question of the multipliers as well.
Professor Bell?
I find it difficult to justify, I think, the freezing of council tax, because in general it benefits better off households. There are some households that are sort of asset rich in terms of housing assets and income poor who will reasonably benefit from the freeze. But you know, I think I would really recommend that at some point the Scottish Government may have to wait until there's clarity around the political situation. But the Royal Society of Edinburgh has produced a paper on council tax reform. And, you know, at some point, it seems to me the Scottish, various Scottish executives, governments have dodged this bullet for quite a long time. Eventually, maybe someone will pick it up.
Yeah,
that's a mixed metaphor, I'm sorry.
To that. I will give you a chance, Mr. Burt, but I did want to touch on another area before my time runs out, and that is the fact that the social security budget is increasing from about $5 billion to $6 billion, which is dramatically more than almost any other sector. Now, I know it's demand-driven, and we've been given evidence before that it's therefore harder to control. But, I mean, are we in a risk here that this is running out of control and we need to somehow tack it in? And I'll come to you first, Mr. Burt, because you would like it to go even higher with the Scottish Child Payment.
I think it's important to separate out the Scottish Child Payment and the disability payments, because they do very different things. The Scottish Child Payment is a means-tested support to families with children, obviously, to reduce child poverty. The disability payments, the replacement of the DLA and PIP system from down south, does something entirely different. And before I go on to say what I'm going to say, anybody who thinks that disabled people in Scotland or across the UK are doing incredibly well out of the social security system and living great lives is having a laugh. I mean, we have seen since the start of this millennium a deepening of poverty in the UK and in Scotland, and a big chunk of that has been amongst disabled people. Governments of kind of all colours have acted to disadvantage disabled people within our society. So that's the context within which we are working. And as I alluded to earlier, the Scottish Government's reforms to that DLA PIP system are entirely welcome in terms of the dehumanisation. You will have had a trail of people through this Parliament of who have been dehumanised by the DLA and PIP system. The fact that that's come to an end is a good thing, full stop. Absolutely. And it is to the Scottish Government's credit that they took that approach. Now, what we see that means is that demand for things that people are eligible for is going up, because hopefully people are less scared of approaching the government for what they have a right to. This Parliament says Social Security is an investment in our people, and people have a right to it. And that's what we're seeing coming into fruition now, at least the SFC projecting that. We also see the negative elements of broader poverty within our society. So we see the SFC projecting that people's kind of anxiety, mental health, decline in their physical health is driving people towards requiring these payments. But let's be clear, these payments are to cover the additional cost of being disabled. They don't even count towards poverty reduction because disabled people have other means of obviously work and other social security payments which support their income. So I think, you know, this, none of this is a, should be a surprise to the Scottish Government. None of that uplift you're talking about is about decisions that they've made in the last year. It's the impact of the positive policy changes that they've made. And it's not something like the weather. This isn't something which is just kind of sprung on us from nowhere. It is the positive impact of policy choices, which means difficult financial decisions, absolutely, and prioritisation. But this is the right prioritisation from my perspective.
OK, Professor Bellamy, I think you nodded to some of that, but should I be worried about the ballooning social security budget?
I agreed with a lot of what Chris said, but one thing, taking a step back, is asking the question about why people need this in the first place. And I would hark back to the Christie Commission and its discussion of the need for prevention and preventative intervention. And again, you know, this is about trying to avoid people getting into difficult situations. Evidence, action. I know that prevention is and because I do quite a lot of work on health as well, is not an easy area to get into. But it would be better for society if there were fewer people in this situation, and if government can invest in preventative interventions, then it should be seriously looking at, because as you say, the budget is increasing very rapidly, and there is really also a crisis in mental health, which has sort of come on us post-pandemic, doesn't appear to be going away as fast as, you know, the threat from COVID itself has gone away.
Okay, thanks. Final word, Dr. Souza.
I was just going to say that, I agree with a lot of what was said. I don't think it should be described as runaway. The budget increase. It's something that's been projected, and runaway kind of implies almost a loss of control. And I don't think there has been a loss of control. This has been projected for years now by the Scottish Fiscal Commission, and it's something that the Scottish Government has known about, and that it needs to consider in its financial planning. And as Chris said before about governing being choosing, that definitely is true. It's a very valid priority. It does come with consequences financially, and that's something that the government needs to consider. I think this partly actually does reflect in some sense something that we keep banging on about, which is multi-year planning for a lot of these things. And I get that it's difficult, and I get that, you know, it might show that there are difficult decisions to be made in the future, and that is not always pleasant, but that, you know, then, given that we have multi-year forecasts for social security spending from the SFC, it would be helpful to then have those multi-year plans and showing what the gap is going forward. And I know that that's done at an aggregate level in the medium-term financial strategy, but we'd like it done at a lower level of planning, so that then a better conversation can be had across Scottish society about what those decisions are going to have to be made.
Okay, thanks. Thanks, Convener.
Okay, thank you. Michael, to be followed by Liz.
Thanks, Convener. One of the areas that's been quite commented on since the budget was announced is the cuts to housing programmes, and certainly Fraser and Allender have highlighted that in their work. I mean, we're looking at affordable housing supply programme cut by over 30% in real terms. That's on top of a greater than 10% cut last year. Housing support and homelessness budget down by 5%. Local government capital budgets down by over 20%. It's at a time when cities are declaring a housing emergency. In terms of the broader impact on that, I wonder, Dr. Souza, if you could pick up on that in the first instance.
So it is really hard to square how that the cuts to the housing, the house building budget and affordable housing supply budget are how they join with the fact that the Scottish Government does have a stated priority of increasing housing supply. And I know that there are other types of housing supply. You know, government doesn't have to be involved in everything, but a lot of the housing supply that is needed is at the lower or more affordable end of the spectrum, and that will have a bigger effect in terms of allowing affordability to perpetuate through the system. So it's difficult to square that, and I know that the convener has mentioned that, you know, that there's choices to be made, and there's difficult decisions to be made. But this is a lot, 30% in real terms. I mean, I think the total cut is about 40-something% in 2 years. That is a lot.
Professor Bell?
Yeah. I mean, I would make couple of points. One is I do wonder if we're looking at we're looking as broadly as we might in relation to solutions as far as affordable housing is concerned. I completely agree that, you know, this is a massive cut in the budget. I was listening recently to a podcast about how productivity in the construction industry has been stagnant for decades. And one of the solutions that I think the Irish government, I could be wrong, has gone for is insisting that affordable housing is not now all modular. So that effectively the housing is built in factories rather than on site. That's one thing. And another thing is that I work with a group, Northwest 2045, which is looking at the west and north coasts of Sutherland. And we always spend our time talking about housing. And the lack of affordable housing in rural areas is contributing significantly to depopulation pressures in those areas.
The three missions that the convener was highlighting, community and public services, sustaining public services, particularly in rural areas, requires affordable housing. There's no doubt about that. Opportunity, we say that that's meant to be about fairness, about green transition, we've already heard about, you know, fuel efficiency, energy efficiency in housing, growth in the economy, and then the equality mission around poverty. I mean, does these cuts comprehensively fail all three of these missions, do they not?
They don't do a lot for them.
No. Okay. Chris Burt?
I mean, the convener is right to push me on the pressure which is on the cap-up budget. But, I mean, I described it as baffling, I think. And I think that's the thing. It's like housing is a foundation for all of our lives. And I'm a bit flowery on this, but like, you know, having somewhere safe, warm, connected, we all need that. You know, it's that hierarchy of needs, etc. It's right up the top. And this Scottish Government has a pretty good record on housing, much better than governments elsewhere in the UK, and that's to their credit. One of the big reactions to the previous downturn in 2010 was, well, let's focus capital funding and we'll focus on things like building houses. That has That was a good decision. And that has meant that poverty rates across the UK have diverged a bit. And Scotland does tend to have lower poverty than England and Wales, and Northern Ireland is slightly different. But, you know, housing's not... You can't, I mean, other than the modular, but you can't build houses overnight. You know, they need to be planned, they need to be in the right places. How you do it in rural areas is different to urban areas. And when we pull back this funding, we reduce predictability, we reduce the sector's ability to draw in private funding. And, you know, we're already seeing an enormous slowdown in completions and starts, of starts and approvals for affordable housing. You know, this sends the wrong message to investors as well. But it also, like, fundamentally, housing is a protection from poverty in a cost sense. If your rents and your mortgages aren't too high, you have more income to go about. And the Scottish Government is investing whatever it is, 450 million quid in the Scottish Child Payment. But if your rents are going up, you're going to prioritise keeping a roof over your head. And that means the family are short for other things. So it just seems, as you say, it has the opportunity or the potential to contribute to all of those aims that the Scottish Government have rightly prioritised. And that's why I think this cut is so difficult to defend.
I suppose it feels to me that it feels very short term. What you're describing is previous long term decisions about the poverty and the health of the country. And that much in this budget, it feels to me, is about dealing with those immediate threats rather than thinking about the long term. I mean, you're nodding there, Professor Bell. Do you feel that, is that your perception?
I think from the autumn statement on the one hand and the Scottish budget on the other, this has not been, these have not been fiscal events for future generations.
From either government?
No.
And Dr. Souza.
I was just going to say that the council budget shortfall relative to plans that has led to the need to the prioritisation that happened over I agree that the autumn statement wasn't brilliant for future generations. Yes, and there's a lot of things that happened in terms of plans in departmental expenditure limits, which includes the allocation for Scotland, that are very constrained and have been kind of penciled in to meet the fiscal targets that the Chancellor has set himself, but the Scottish Government was already not on track to fulfil all its capital plans in the medium-term financial strategy. There was already a £500 million gap there. And so it does not all come just from the autumn statement.
Chris?
I wouldn't necessarily say that it was entirely short-termist. What I think is happening is that the Scottish Government has to balance its budget. So it gets that scramble towards the end of the year. The autumn statement was very late. We did it, the Scottish budget was on Christmas Day or whenever it was. And everything had to be squeezed in at the last minute. And that feels like the Cabinet Secretary had to argue to balance off this budget. And like, I do not think for a second that anybody in the Scottish Government will take any pleasure from this cut to the housing budget at all. But I think what hasn't happened is, like, we're doing a project just now with cash, looking at the affordable housing supply programme and how do we get the most return for that investment in terms of poverty reduction? Because I think those are the kind of questions that have to make. If the Scottish Government were saying, look, the broader conditions in the housing sector are such that in this financial year, our investment could be less and we could focus that investment, say, on rural affordability issues. But that's not what we're hearing. It just feels like we've got to squeeze under a budget line.
Okay. Chris, can I ask you on the Parental Employability Support Fund? That's something that Joseph Renchie Foundation have been very keen on in the past. And the Social Security Secretary said that I'm afraid the fund has just run its course as a concept. Your reflections on that?
Yeah, I think that this is a bit of my worry about Best Start Bright Futures, which was the the Tackling Child Poverty Reduction Plan. There was lots in that, rightly, on the focus on how you support more parents into work. And one of the solutions around that was that Parental Employability Support Fund. Now, that was focused initially on upfront childcare costs. The UK government made a welcome decision to allow more people to get upfront childcare costs through universal credit system. But then that money was essentially, because it wasn't spent, was reprioritised for something else, for the Fuel Insecurity Fund, which has now been cut. And I think this is my worry, that this budget, it's not that there aren't things in it which protect people from poverty, which the Scottish Government have already committed to and announced, things like a child payment. Yeah, absolutely. It's that the things which were to push us towards the child poverty reduction targets, like that fund, are gone now.
Yes, so that's not what the Cabinet Secretary said. What she said is run its course as a concept, like it's a failed concept, it wasn't a choice. She's told the committee, the Social Justice and Social Security Committee, that on the 14th of September. I mean, is that your view, that as a concept it failed?
I think in the way that it's designed, from my understanding, is that they spoke to the UK government, who said, well, we would treat that as income, so you can't provide the fund in a particular way. But could they have spent that money in other ways that would have supported more parents getting to work? Yeah, of course.
Okay. So yesterday, the First Minister made a speech about the economy and creating different choices that he would want to make. He said in that speech that if he could marshal £2 billion of capital annually, £20 billion over 10 years, then he could deliver growth levels at the level of China in the 1990s. Professor Bell, do you think that's realistic?
So it would be good to be able to be spending significant amounts of capital. Of course, one issue is when China developed, basically it had unlimited labour resource at very, very low cost, and that would, that situation is not replicated here. It had a very, a very supportive infrastructure, huge investment around the country, sort of directed rather than developed through a market system. So I think the situations are very different. I my comparator would not be China if I was thinking about what we could what Scotland could potentially do, and I do think that timescales tend to be very difficult to pin down and often much longer than people expect them to be.
Yeah, so we've highlighted the cut to capital spending in this budget, £400 million, 484, thank you, convener. So this would be four times that. But could we realistically say if we were to produce four times the level of, or put that money back three times more on top of it, we could produce growth rates that were double-digit growth rates in Scotland? Is that realistic, Dr. Sousa? Because, if that's possible, then I kind of think that might be what the committee would want to be getting into recommending. Could we find that money and get 10% growth in Scotland? Not in the 1990s. We grew at double-digit rates. And that's what the comparison is, and it's what would be required to raise the level of income in this country to the levels that the First Minister is suggesting.
I won't go into the comparators. What I will say is that Scotland is already a high income country, therefore a lot of catch up growth that emerging economies do have in the short run or over even very long periods of time, we've already had that many years ago over bigger periods of time. So if you compare growth historically, we've already had a lot of it. It would be nice to grow at 2.5% rather than 1.4%. That would be a great outcome. That would be transformative to go at 2.5% every year.
Yeah. Okay. Any thoughts on this, Chris?
Not really. We need more capital investment. Yeah. And the UK has structurally underinvested in stuff for years. How we go about that, I'll leave that to the learned economists.
I will just say, Scotland does have lower investment as a share of GDP than the UK average. So Scotland could benefit from having more investment and might have some catch-up in that regard in terms of GDP if that were the case. But we're not talking about double-digit catch-up.
That's going to be
determine what you spent it on as well. Let's take it forward by Ross.
Thank you. Can I concentrate on economic inactivity, which, as you have rightly said this morning, not only affects economic growth, but it actually affects well-being as well. And I firmly believe that what we have to do in Scotland is to improve or address that situation so that the economic inactivity is reduced. Could I ask each of you what you feel about many of the comments within the business and industry sectors following the budget, that the budget hasn't done enough to address the concerns about inactivity, but also to try to stimulate growth in the areas where there would be the higher paid jobs. Can I ask for your reflections on that?
So one of the things that I think is a bit concerning about the budget is the effect on colleges. So if people have, for whatever reason, become inactive, what we're not good at is retraining them to rejoin the labour market, and colleges can play a hugely positive role in that respect. There's the educational aspect and there's also the health aspect. You know, is inactivity down to reasons of poor health? And again, understanding the processes involved there seems to me to be important. And I have already referenced the mental health set of issues. Now, unfortunately, my fallback position on looking at the stats on this, the labour force survey, has been a bit. Its reputation has been tarnished in the last little while. So it's not really clear what the extent of inactivity, especially among older people, which was thought to be almost an epidemic post-pandemic. So we're not entirely sure about that at the moment, but clearly the business sector is observing.
That point, Professor Billy, I think it's a very interesting point about whether we have sufficiently accurate data about the reasons why people are inactive. Do you think there is a gap in the data? Or what do we have to do to try? Because if we don't have the right data, it's obviously very difficult to address the policy concern.
Sure. So the Labour Force Survey traditionally asked people, give them a list of reasons why they didn't want to engage with the labour market. It's not so much that these reasons are don't cover the options, although mental health used to be a very small segment, and now it's a very large segment, and maybe you need to fine-tune within that area a bit more. But the main problem has been that the sample size of the labour force survey is halved over the years. There's a question about how representative it is, and therefore how you have to weight it. And what has happened is that administrative data on HMRC, for example, seem to be telling a different story from what the Labour Force Survey is saying. And that's a problem. I think ONS are going to address that in the year with possibly a revised version of it. But for all of these things, if you want, if you want to take effective policy action, you've got to base that effective action on accurate data.
On the point about the Labour Force Survey, that we have no sub-UK data that's being published at the moment from the ONS. And that's because the survey has got such a low response rate as a whole that they can't really rely on it for UK-wide numbers, let alone sub-UK results. So we actually have... I mean, we don't really know the level of inactivity in Scotland. Mm. I mean, we barely even know it at a UK level, and we're expecting the ONS to provide data based on the what's called the Transformed Labour Force Survey from, I think, March onwards. But the extent to which that is compared... So they were doing kind of testing of that alongside the existing Labour Force Survey, but the fact that the existing one isn't really fit for purpose means that we don't really know how comparable the estimates of the new survey will be to the old one.
Yeah, I had it put to me by a Finnish colleague yesterday that we should stop basing our data on regular surveys, but rather have a register, as they do in say Scandinavia. All the Scandinavian countries have registers, and effectively we do have a register through what's called the Community Health Index, your NHS number. If you added a little bit more data to that, you would have a much more up-to-date and regular picture.
So just for clarity, Professor, well, you think that the ONS is doing something about this issue? It's quite serious if we don't have the right information. Can I just ask, in terms of making Scotland a more attractive place in which to live, to work and to invest, what policies within the budget area that is the available to Scotland do you think the priority should be put? Professor Bell, you were very... clear in your evidence, your article, I think it was on the 20th of December, immediately after the budget, and also this morning, that you don't think the budget has prioritised growth enough. What policies would you like to see?
We've all alluded to the difficulties, but the capital budget has to be a starting point for that. And I've got to say that the skills, the relevance of skills. We've talked about the Scottish National Investment Bank, so we have to have sort of a facilitating environment for business investment. Otherwise, you don't grow incomes. You don't grow incomes. You cannot pay for social security. And the consequences in the long run are difficult.
Okay. Mr. Burt?
Just to slightly reverse back into your issue around the economic inactivity as well. I do think, you know, obviously if people are going to invest here, they want access to a healthy labour market. And I do think at the moment we are making it awfully difficult for people who are in this situation. We have fairly miserly social security support, as David has alluded to, mental health support, which we hear all the time as part of a kind of structural issue for why people are in poverty and often locked out of the labour market, just isn't there. NHS waiting times contribute to that too. But part of that is also on employers. Employers in a tight labour market, employers need to be able to show more flexibility, particularly for disabled people and particularly for parents. And that, you know, this isn't a simple issue of there is a government fix to this. It's not just on business as well. And I think to see more of that partnership and to work around people to help them into work. And I think having that, you know, that ease of access to the labour market for people coming in too is a benefit to both sides of the coin.
Do you think there's sufficient understanding about the skills issue that the employers know enough about where the problems are with the skills agenda? Do you think that knowledge is good within business?
I think there is. These words are difficult to say, so excuse me if I trip over them. We often put a lot of focus on employability in terms of putting the focus on the individual rather than employability. And I think we probably need a bit of both. So employers being able to understand more about what are the practical barriers that people face into getting work or into getting the sort of skills that you talk about. And actually, employers knowing more about that, individuals knowing more about the access to services that are available in their areas, and those services being responsive to both individual and business needs.
I mean, the Scottish Government cutting the budget for employability by the £30 million in the cash terms. But do you think that employability budget has to be separated out a little bit about awareness for employers and for employees?
I think some of the best employability services at the moment in Scotland are provided by the third sector. And what the reason why is because A, they understand the people that are supporting, and B, they understand the communities which they serve and the businesses which are part of that community. Mm-hmm. And I think at the minute, employability funding, with it, I mean, it's hard to know what the Scottish Government is spending on employability, to be honest. But I think it could really do with somebody taking a deep breath, pausing and focusing on that sort of level of support rather than what we have just now. But it is a concern, yeah.
I would go along with that around the third sector contribution to that. Of course, the third sector is less apparent in the rural, especially the remote rural areas, for understandable reasons. And I keep alluding back to Sutherland. I keep hearing housing, but I then hear childcare as the next issue, and childcare is a thing that employers need to engage with as well.
Mm. And can I just finish my questions, Convener? Dr. Souza, you mentioned earlier, and other panellists have mentioned, about the importance of the college sector. Can I just ask about this cut to the Scottish Funding Council and the ramifications that might have? Because, I think both the college sector and university sector are absolutely critical to developing Scotland, to the economic growth, apart from anything else, but to making the best use of the assets that we have. How critical do you think that funding cut is?
So I was... The first time I saw this was in a letter to yourselves about the 23-24 cut, and then subsequent cut in future years. I think that it transpired by looking again at the level four tables. So I am surprised that is a decision that has been taken, given the fact that skills are such an important thing. And they can have really long-term ramifications. Their investment in human capital, essentially, even if they come out of the resource budget in most cases. So that means that if we're training fewer people in areas that we might want to focus on, and David in particular mentioned the retraining element, which is key for industries that might no longer be viable in the long term, and for whose employees it will be required that they train on to doing something else. And that kind of also staves off, in some sense, the threat of inactivity from people who have been employed for a long time and have built up capital in a particular industry. That is a concern, in my opinion.
Okay, thank you. Ross, to follow by Jamie.
Thanks. Convener. Excuse me. I'd like to go back to the convener's original line of question, because collectively what we've heard so far this morning is arguments that the budget doesn't prioritise economic growth enough, it doesn't prioritise tackling poverty enough, it doesn't prioritise tackling reaching our net zero targets enough, specific criticism of the lack of funding for skills and training, university places, affordable housing, the Scottish Child Payment, enterprise agencies, the National Investment Bank, etc, 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 and scepticism about tax rises to raise additional revenue. Isn't this the problem? It's really easy to identify what this budget doesn't do, but there's little in the way of solutions to that. Now, Chris, to be fair, you identified almost straight away that the money for the council tax freeze could instead have been spent on increasing the Scottish Child Payment. Absolutely, my criticism of the council tax freeze is on the record. I would agree with you on that. But cumulatively, the government went into this with a £1.5 billion gap. And what I've not heard yet this morning is a clear identification of where the government is spending money on the wrong things. What could be reprioritised to fill all the gaps that you've all quite fairly identified? These are all areas I think there'd be a consensus that we should spend more money on, but there isn't more money, is the point.
And what I've not yet heard this morning is identification of where that money could come from, especially if it's not going to come from pretty swinging tax rises.
So, I guess my argument would be that really these decisions are political decisions, but they should be made in an informed way, and that that circumstances have not been ideal given the kind of timetable of everything that this autumn, but nevertheless, the medium-term financial strategy did point out that there was an issue, and essentially, rather than making the decisions in what appeared to be the last minute, things might have been taken forward in a more considered way. Because I agree, there is not enough money here, and there was no way of inventing additional money. But my point is that we have to be in a situation where there are considered plans in place to deal with situations where there's a sudden shock. It might be a reconciliation. Reconciliations could cost us £1 billion easily. So it seems to me you have to be have to take perhaps a more we all say long term, but a more considered view, so that we know that if something really bad happens in terms of the overall budget, we have an understanding, people have an understanding of how decisions are going to be made.
I think I agree with a lot of that, and I agree that, my point in highlighting a lot of the areas has not been to say you shouldn't do that. That's not my place here to say that, and it's not the issue's place. It's to highlight the things that are kind of like left unsaid by the budget statement that I think you as a committee should consider and then query, with the Cabinet Secretary for Finance, for example, how do you square this with your priorities? And there are arguments for doing a lot of the things that were done. I mean, we've all kind of criticised council tax in particular, but for all the other things, there are arguments for it. It's the trade-off of that is implied by it that I think is really important to highlight here. The other thing I should say is that the medium-term financial strategy was back in May, and I don't think we all knew and we all know that a projected shortfall cannot happen, and therefore we know roughly, in the absence of anything else, how much almost the axe is going to fall on, and then it's a question of distributing where that goes. So there's like 6 months in between events. So yeah, even if the autumn segment is really close to it, the medium-term financial strategy wasn't.
And I think the other thing as well is that that the choices which were made, the final choices that were made in the budget, were the only possible choices. As David says, there are political decisions laced within it. Within the couple of weeks that we've had to have a look at it, we haven't had the time to study it in detail. But I do think your point is quite fundamental, and it comes back to something that Michael asked earlier as well, is the Parliament has set targets for having very low poverty in Scotland, for having much lower carbon emissions. And quite rightly, good. It's an ambition which is shared by all the politicians here. But we need to do more to get there, and we cannot sit here and go, well, we've spent all the money, we're stuck. because we're not stuck, but we have to do things and we're going to have to change things. As I say, around the housing supply programme, maybe there are ways in which we have to change how we target that funding to impact on cost and impact on poverty. Council tax is a very obvious one. We've talked about council tax reform for years and everybody has dodged it. Let's stop dodging it. We have greatly expanded the availability of childcare. Good, that is needed. But if we're going to keep going, we probably do need to have a debate about how we're going to pay for that. It needn't necessarily be taxed. Are there contribution systems? Same in social care. Mental health support is fundamental. These are all things that you would all nod and agree at, but we're not having the debate about how we as a society say, this is what we expect from our government and our public sector, and this is how we are going to collectively contribute towards it. Because if we accept today that we're stuck, then those ambitions that this Parliament have won't be achieved.
I think that is a really pertinent point. There's perhaps a challenge there. It's well within the Parliament's power to legislate for targets. The challenge we've got is the range of powers we have to reach those targets is a limited range, though you're right, Chris, that we've not fully utilised those. Just touch on a couple of specifics, and going back to the discussion early on around the income tax changes and splitting the higher rate. David, if I could ask you first, was it not somewhat strange, or at the moment, is it not somewhat strange to have a higher rate with such a massive range to it? Between 45 and 125 grand, to be taxing at the same rate between those, it's a massive range to be doing that, all acknowledging that from 100 onwards, the withdrawal of the personal allowance obviously has an effect. But was that, even in European terms, it's somewhat unusual to have such a big range for one rate?
I think you're probably right. Because I refer to them in my paper, I was looking at the OECD schedules in other countries. Some countries, I think Belgium is really, really, ramping up every 10,000, something like that. I think that's what you mean.
Yeah.
I think probably, I don't know if you, my quick scan of the OECD's income tax schedules suggests that in general the gaps aren't as big as 45 to 125 or whatever. But it is also the case that although that may be an issue with the UK income tax system, there is also the massive issue around the way that it interacts with national insurance, plus also the removal of the personal allowance, which I think was done by the Labour government, is an issue because it creates, all of a sudden you go into a stratospheric marginal rate, which no other country copies. So, I mean, there's a case for reviewing income tax and national insurance together. That is complicated by the fact that in Wales and Scotland, income tax is a devolved, or the bands and rates are devolved, and the systems are different as between Scotland and Wales. So it's a bit of a mess, the whole thing.
Yeah, we actually did some work on this prior to the budget, trying to look at, particularly at the distortion around the £43,000 to £50,000 income tax marginal rates, which interact, as you said, with the national insurance because people pay the higher rate of national insurance rather than the 2%. I prefer to focus on that one because that one is easier for the Scottish Government and the Scottish Parliament to do something about. And I know that it raises a lot of money. I think we estimate it raises about £600 million a year, not raising the threshold. And so what we looked at is, could you do something to rates to bring in the same amount of revenue roughly, but remove that kink in the... And that would actually increase progressivity in the system, because that would mean that people, say, employees at £45,000 would pay lower rates than people earning £55,000, which surely is what a progressive system should do.
Jumping around somewhat, Chris, to the points that you made earlier on, particularly around capital affordable housing, you highlighted the roads budget as an area that could be reprioritised. If you listen to my Conservative colleagues, apparently my party has already done that and the roads budget has gone down significantly. It is up this year, but that is, with the exception of an amount of money for the A9 that I'm not enthusiastic about, but it's a small amount. It's mostly for safety critical infrastructure. Is there not a wider point, though, with the affordable housing? Nobody would defend that as a good outcome. That's £196 million down or whatever it is thereabouts. That's not a good outcome of this process. But affordable housing is an area of capital spend where there are other policy levers available. So there's been an emergency rent freezing cap, there are eviction protections, there's permanent rent controls coming in, there's regulation of short-term lets, which should hopefully free up more housing, doubling a council tax on holiday homes, whereas there's other areas of capital spend where there's no legislative or policy alternative to reach those same eventual outcomes. You know, I think it was David that pointed out a lot of net zero spend in particular. It can't really be done any other way than a lot of our net zero targets can't be done any other way than through hitting capital spend. So as much as the affordable housing decision is a really unpleasant one, nobody says it's going to be a good outcome, there are other levers the government can pull there within the limited context of devolution. There are other options to hit our ambitions for housing, not excluding capital spend. Is that not correct?
Well, I live just off the A9, so I will stop my comments on roads. obviously, the capital investment in housing is not the only thing about it. Although I would say that, like, homelessness support budget doesn't seem to have gone down a bit as well. But the fundamental issues which are within our housing system at the moment, why do we need rent caps, why do we need rent controls, etc., are because of our lack of supply. We need more affordable housing. They'll stop. If we can find different ways of doing that, grand, but we don't have those yet.
I think there probably are. Sorry, Joe, bring in a second. Just on that point of other options, and there is a lot of other money out there. The most obvious example to me is public sector pension funds invest billions and billions of pounds into all sorts of stuff all the time. Our public sector pension funds invest very little into public infrastructure like affordable housing, and that's not a criticism of them. There's no setup to connect them with that, despite the fact that they've got billions of pounds to put in. So there probably are other options that we can explore to get more money into areas like that. Pension funds, I think, is just one example. But sorry.
I was just going to say that there can be, especially in terms of supply constraints in terms of housing, there can be a benefit to just, you know, if there's always some leakage in incentivising measures to release supply, whereas it can, on the other hand, be more direct to just, you know, intervene and create that. So there's a kind of a decision to be made and an assessment to be made, I think, from the government side to as to whether which of them is preferable and what level of leakage there is in terms of that. The other thing is, I think what would be helpful would be to have a more spelled out direction, which I think what doesn't feel like there was a lot in this budget in particular with the housing supply, is that there's no joined up thinking of, like, what are we doing overall to these areas, and it just feels like this was cut because something had to be, and
to
this is something that
yeah,
kind of can be paused because you're just bringing new things online, and it just doesn't necessarily feel like the best way of making those decisions.
Yeah. I've taken up quite a lot of time, Commissioner. Do I have time for one more question?
Of course. Okay.
Just going back to the point you made, David, around attracting investment and the cuts to the enterprise agencies. This might be maybe too specific a question, but are the enterprise agencies necessarily the best place for us to put money to attract investment? Thinking of the coverage over the last couple of days of the incredible success of our film and TV sector, which I would argue is largely driven by the fact that responsibility for state support for that has been taken away from the enterprise agencies and given to a bespoke unit within Creative Scotland, the new screens or new-ish Screen Scotland. Have the enterprise, or particularly Scottish Enterprise, I think High and Sosie are different and do have a justifiable return. Has Scottish Enterprise been able to really demonstrate that the spend that we've put into it has resulted in increased investment? Because you've pointed out that spend on Scottish Enterprise has actually gone down at the same time as foreign direct investment in Scotland has gone up.
Yeah, that's a very reasonable question, it seems to me, and I haven't looked at the data recently. You know, there was a time when Scottish Enterprise or its predecessor was doing very well in attracting what were effectively the companies that formed Silicon Glen. The nature of the world has changed a lot since then. We are effectively a service economy. We're not a manufacturing economy. And therefore, a lot of the areas where we do want to attract don't necessarily lead to huge requirements for concrete and buildings in general. So I'm open to that. To that, the idea that industry specific areas may or may not do better. Clearly, something like Visit Scotland is an important potential agent for supporting what is a key industry for Scotland going forward. But I don't think the enterprise agencies are unaware of all of this. So I think the question you've raised is a very fair one. But I don't think the cuts were demonstrably there on the basis of an assessment that they were doing badly.
But that goes back to the point that was made, Gerard just made about the affordable housing. Of if we made decisions in every portfolio area purely on the basis of what's going to generate the best long-term return in that area, we would have almost certainly ended up with a budget that didn't add up. That ultimately, the budget had to add up one way or another. Sure. Thanks, Camir.
Thank you very much, Jamie.
Thanks very much, Convener. Good morning to the panel. I was going to speak about our last questions on economic growth, but I think we've kind of covered that fairly well today. So just very quickly on the point that the question that Ross was doing and others have raised, and I think you've raised some of yourselves, do you get an understanding of, is there a clarity on what this budget is trying to achieve from the Scottish Government? And do you think the Scottish Government has explained its direction, its ambitions, and also where it has cut? I think Dr. Susie talked about some of the inconsistencies, particularly around woodland grants. You know, why is it a priority one year but not a priority this year? Do you think there is enough of an explanation from the Scottish Government on why some of these decisions have been made? If I can come to you, Professor Bell, first.
It was a budget necessarily made in haste, as it often is, and I think, you know, we've had a lot of discussions about short-termism, and I think a lot of that has to do with the budget process, and I've been and discussed the budget process for decades now, and it still seems to be a very compressed affair. I think back to things like the National Strategy for Economic Transformation and think, well, how does this budget link up to that, and it's not very clear to me how it does. So that's a sort of growth prerogative, but of course, you know, there's a set of other issues. There's the social justice area and so on, but I don't see a narrative that says how that's all been added into the budgetary process and a clear narrative come out of it.
Okay. And Chris Burt?
Just hark back to something that Gerard just said. The housing thing is a good example. Like, I'm never going to sit here and tell you, oh, cutting the housing capital budget was a good thing. But if the Scottish Government were to say, look, we are under an incredible pressure this year, so we have reduced capital funding for housing for, you know, even with an ambition and later, again, multi-year planning discuss. But if it was because this year we are going to do bang, bang, bang to meet these longer term outcomes, mm-hmm. and our aim is to, so for, you know, on the social housing bill, they've got a plan to spend 3.6 billion within this parliament. Is that gone? I mean, it looks that way, but we're not having that discussion. Now, I understand that would be an awkward political discussion, but it would be, but it would be much harder for me to sit here and say, well, this looks like a big problem. If we were discussing, well, actually, the Scottish Government, yes, have reduced this budget, we're going to target on these things, then that, I think, would be a more productive discussion, yeah.
And do you think that's the case both in the areas that there are cuts as well as the areas, perhaps, that there's been increases in investment? For example, are the Scottish Government better at saying, well, this is what we want to do, we're putting money into this, than they are justifying where cuts are made?
Perhaps that's fair. I haven't thought about it in great detail, to be honest. But I do think there is something about being intentional and saying, look, we are going to spend this money. You know, that, for example, the mental health support stuff. If they said, look, we don't have the money to spend lots of money on mental health support and on employability support, but we hear all the time from people about the mental health struggles that they face, so we are going to prioritise investment in that and distance it. You know, those are the kind of choices that you have to make. And no, I don't feel like we get that balance between, yes, we're going to positively do this, and for that reason, we're not doing that.
Okay, thanks. And Dr.
I mean, if you look at a budget document, it is necessarily something that has loads of different measures, and it is then everyone tries to, the government weaves a narrative of together to explain why they've done what they've done. And those decisions are also made based on the priorities that they've identified. But essentially, I think there's a point of, like, it's easier to just highlight the things that are priorities, and I understand why that would be the case. But then I think, as Chris said, that is why then we come here to this panel and highlight all the things that were left unspoken from the budget, and some. One of the things that I think makes something stronger rather than weaker is acknowledging those trade-offs and bringing things together in a coherent way that means that you can understand how the decisions have been made and how things that might be across different portfolios come together to form one direction of travel in a particular area, because the portfolio... Different portfolios can have responsibility for things that have that kind of cut across them. So employability might be in work and fair economy, yeah. Fair work and well-being economy, whereas mental health is on health. But they can be related, and how those interact is important to understand when you're making decisions about which one to prioritise.
Thank you for that. Just very quickly, I'm obviously a Highlands and Islands MSP. I represent a huge part of rural Scotland. We've talked about housing within rural areas. We've talked about, I think, the importance of delivering health services, how it's more expensive, local public services, transport, etc. We talked about council services, obviously, in Orkney, and the fact that my council tax bill is going to be going up. I was just wondering if you could give me your thought, perhaps starting with yourself, Dr. Sousa, on the impact on rural Scotland, whether there's any particular comments or concerns you have, given the difficulty sometimes in delivering those services.
I think we know that some of the geographical challenges just mean things are harder to deliver consistently across councils and so I am concerned about the kind of blanket approach to the council tax compensation. I think that could have some unintended consequences across councils. I think there's then some of the issues about some of the opportunities from things like I talked about woodland grants and things like that. You know, just a lot of the projects that rely on Scotland's geography are less, you know, less front of mind necessarily when they're being decided, but they can have important consequences for net zero targets and things like that. So that's something that will be important to think about in terms of the priority of the growing and greener economy that we talked about.
Thanks, Chris.
One thing I just highlight, and I should declare an interest here, I'm a member of the Aberfeldy Development Trust, and we look at affordable housing within our area as well. But I do think the housing issue is absolutely key, because it glues everything together. Yes, of course, there's affordability of that and the seasonal element of work and how that interacts with people's rents, but also how businesses are able to flourish, to be able to have employees of working age living in those areas too. So I do think, and you know, welcomely, the Affordable Housing Supply Programme did have an element which focused on rural homes. So any contraction of that, I think is a concern.
We know that we have too many people living in our island communities, particularly Skye and Orkney and others, who are living in substandard accommodation, but also there's such a shortage of accommodation that people who want to live and work in those areas can't live and work in that. So I think it's a really important issue. And Professor Bell.
I'm from the Highlands as well. I pointed out in my paper that the Rural Affairs, Land Reform and Islands resource budget fell by about 13%. Issues like depopulation, which relates back to housing, childcare and so on, are fuel poverty, all are big issues. One thing that hasn't been mentioned so far is agriculture and support for agriculture, which has fallen quite considerably in real terms, which is tough for crofters who are receiving a higher proportion of their income from the state than arable farmers. So, you know, the budget does pose a particular challenge, particularly in areas like the Highlands, which don't get the benefit of additional funding like the Islands do.
I mean, I'd obviously have to declare an interest as a partner in a farming business if we mentioned that, but I think it's absolutely valid. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Jamie, and I'd like to thank our witnesses today. We've overrun our time quite considerably. That's because of the interesting questions that were asked and the very interesting responses that we received. So I want to thank our witnesses. Normally I would ask you if you had any final points, but we don't have time for that at the moment. So just to thank you, and we'll take a break until 11:35 when we will have our next panel. Thank you. Okay then, folks, so for the second part of the evening session of the Scottish Budget 24-25, I'd like to welcome to the meeting Richard Robinson, Senior Manager, Performance Audit and Best Value, Audit Scotland, Dr Jenny Peachey, Senior Policy Advocate, Carnegie UK, Shona Struthers, Chief Executive Officer, Colleges Scotland, Stacey Dingwall, Head of Policy and External Affairs Scotland, Federation of Small Businesses, Martin Booth, Executive Director of Finance at Glasgow City Council, Keir Greenaway, Senior Organiser for Public Services, GMB Scotland, Francesca Osovska, Chief Executive Nature Scott, and Kirsten Hogg, Head of Policy and Research, Scottish Council of Voluntary Organisations. So what we're going to do this is, it's not a question of me just asking you all a load of questions. I'm only going to ask one question to start off with, and that's going to be to Stacey, first of all, and then people can come in with any comments they want to make to the comments that perhaps Stacey's made, or if they want to take the discussion a different direction. I mean, we're not going to go through this in some kind of stultified theme approach. It'll just be for people to come in when they wish to on the issues they so wish. And if we get stuck, I'll drag somebody in to keep things moving. So when people want to speak, just obviously let me know with a nod or whatever, or clerks to know, or signalling. Okay, so let's fire away. So first one is something that we've not really touched on in the first panel session. What the Deputy First Minister told the Chamber was, and I quote, prioritising health spending has meant the government is less able to support the business sector. So I'm just wondering, Stacey, what your view on that is from the view of the Federation of Small Businesses.
Yeah, thank you, Convener. I think the previous panel talked a lot about making choices, and I would say that when we heard that during the budget statement, I think our reaction was that those choices maybe aren't as binary. No, just because you do this doesn't mean to say you can't do both of those. It's about, you know, we make choices. I think we talked a lot about, you know, we choose to do things like, you know, not saying that these are bad decisions, but, you know, we choose to keep offering non-means tested benefits like three prescriptions to everyone in Scotland, but we also want to do other things. So, and I think the previous panel touched on that, it's like, well, if we do want to do this new thing, does that mean to say we can still keep doing what we have been doing? And, you know, we all have to make choices like that in our daily budgets. You know, if I want to do this, that means I'll have to stop doing that. So I think our reaction was that it's not as binary as that. For instance, one of our big asks was around passing on that 75% rates relief to retail, hospitality and leisure that the UK government have extended to March 2025. Now, we know in Scotland it's been since July 2022, I believe, since any relief was available to those businesses. And I know that was calculated about £230 million, I think, the Barnett consequentials. Then I know Fraser Ballander, looking at the valuation role for this year, have calculated it would actually cost the Scottish Government about £360 million to replicate that in Scotland. And I think that's because, obviously, you can't really compare the different rates relief systems. They're not comparable. There's different complexities. But then we look at, you know, the Welsh Government. They have chosen to pass on 40% relief to those businesses in Wales up to March 2025. So our push was really for, because the systems are different, because we know that the small business bonus scheme offers a lot of benefits, particularly to our members, it was looking at maybe not, if we're not able to pass on the 75% relief, because those businesses already get other reliefs, for example, SBBS, was there something like around the 40% relief that maybe the Scottish Government could have replicated as they did in Wales?
I mean, I suppose the issue for the Scottish Government is where would they have found, you know, the proportion of that £360 million from, because they already give £685 million in non-domestic relief. And indeed, as someone who represents Islands, they actually increased relief to all businesses with the rates up to £110,000. They'll now get 100% relief. John, you wanted to come in?
Yes, well, it wasn't that point. Strangely enough, I met the hospitality sector yesterday. And, I mean, some of the hospitality sector are very profitable and don't need support, and some are struggling and do need support. So given that you were arguing that, say, for prescriptions it should be targeted, do you not think that any support for business needs to be targeted at those that need it?
Yes, absolutely. And I know it's a big ask for the hospitality sector now to look at introducing a specific rate for hospitality businesses.
All hospitality businesses?
I would say that has to be targeted. I think you are correct. I'm part of the work of the New Deal for Business group looking at reform of rates. We've not had time to specifically get into detail as much as that, but I would expect that as something that we would look at as the work of that group continues. Thank
you. Okay, Jamie.
Just on actually on that point, I mean, obviously this 75% relief is for retail as well. I think that's something we've all probably seen in more noticeable as our high streets, more and more business spaces becoming available. I was speaking to some local business people about the increases in their rents, which have gone up, I think, from 12,000 to 18,000 on a new lease. Without increased support, without giving support to those retail businesses, what are your concerns, I suppose, for our high streets? Because it's a big issue for, I think, all of the MSPs here.
Yeah, well, I mean, the Businesses in Scotland statistics released just before Christmas showed that we lost 3,500 in retail hospitality and accommodation businesses, and over 20,000 businesses overall, mainly in those the kind of 0 to 49, so the smallest of businesses. So, you know, just over 20,000 businesses was what we lost in the first year of the pandemic, and we lost that again last year. So if we can't offer support, then it kind of looks like that's going to continue, unfortunately.
The Economy Committee that I was on did an inquiry into town centres, and I think Michelle was on as well, and came up with some suggestions. I think it's probably a repeated process in committees of this Parliament looking at high streets and our town centres and how we can make them sustainable. If we don't get it right, we don't get tax level right, support level right, and some of the wider issues around access to town centres, both within this budget and others, do they have a future?
Well, I mean, you look at some of our biggest high streets, you know, Sucky Hall Street. You know, I'm from Glasgow. If you look at the difference in Sucky Hall Street in the last 15 years, we don't have that investment, then I just don't see how we improve it, unfortunately.
Okay.
Blair?
Different tack, but I was just wanting to bring it back to the government's ambitions of opportunity, community and equality. And the college sector has seen an equivalent to 5% cut in its budget. It's a sector that's suffered cuts for the last decade, but it's a sector that delivers on all of those things. It gives opportunity to people, it gives them hope, it gives them skills, it gives them work. It supports the economy to do that, and it supports communities. All that fabric where colleges support communities and support the people in it, if you keep cutting and cutting the way that the cuts have been done by the budgets, it is death by a thousand cuts. Yep. It's not a strategy. It's almost like the budget's been, if everyone just gets a little bit of a cut, it'll add up. That's not a strategy. And if you really do want to deliver on equality, opportunity and community, you need to invest. And the college sector has shown that the investment, the Fraser of Allender, the recent report in November, it's a great return on investment. And we need to grow the economy and give people hope and give our businesses purpose.
John?
Your paper says repurposing existing resources. Can you tell us what that means? Does that mean cut the universities and especially cut the richer universities?
No, I'm not advocating that at all. I mean, the university sector has also seen a cut as a sector. What I'm proposing is you've got £3.2 billion in a skills system. And I think the Minister will be speaking tomorrow on the Withers report. There's been the Hayward review. There's been purpose and principles. There's been a lot of work around the whole skills system. It's about making sure that any duplication is taken out. It's about targeting it. It's making sure that the investment that the government has already made in colleges, which is significant and substantial, get the best return on that. Invest in them properly. This 5% cut that's happened is you're going to close campuses, you're going to have less students go to college, you're going to be less curriculum. It's just lots and lots of tiny cuts. It's not a strategy. So it's repurpose the skills money that you have. We're not asking to, you know, take from others for the benefit of us. We're just saying invest properly and you'll get a better return.
Jenny.
Thank you. Thank you for participating today. I suppose one of the things I'm very thoughtful about, and the thing that seems to be coming out and came out in the earlier session was you know, this discussion about what should go from one budget line to another budget line, and there's clearly no easy answer with this. And I suppose I was thinking about sort of the starting point and an outcomes focus, really, I suppose. And it was really encouraging to see the outcomes in the budget, but were they bolted on or were they sort of built in from the outset. And I suppose where I'm coming from with that is New Zealand and their living standards framework. And there is the living standards survey. It helps officials identify where are the wellbeing priority outcomes for the people of New Zealand. And then departments bid to the wellbeing fund to address those issues. And those departments that work cross-departmentally and those bids that seek to sort of deliver on a range of outcomes are given priority in the budget. And I suppose what made me think about that was that, you know, colleges do an awful lot of things beyond what the stereotype might be. You know, so it's a way of, I suppose, constructing the budget slightly differently, I suppose. And I suppose the question we had was, would it be interesting or helpful to explore sort of with a more longer-term view, obviously not with just this year's, but, you know, is there a way to think about, is this outcome sort of really the starting point for thinking about what to spend and how to spend and then how people can come together to deliver on those set outcomes, as it were, rather than starting with the priorities and saying, oh, then this links to this outcome and it's that outcome, because then it's also easy perhaps to kind of measure and monitor progress and see whether there's success in delivering those outcomes. And again, also able to see, you know, where the priority outcomes are, they're being given more budget or is that being sort of protected in any way? So I realise that sounds a little abstract and a bit kind of a step back almost, but it's sort of related to me to some of the things I was hearing sort of in the previous session and from colleagues.
So do you think...
Hold on a second, Liz, because Michael's wanting to come in.
I suppose it's on this point that the... Reflecting a little bit on that previous session, we have long-term targets in Scotland, whether those be around reducing child poverty, whether those be around climate change and our targets in those areas. But it feels to me that the budget is much more short-term than actually looking at those long-term that are set out by this government, the priorities that they have, about how you get there. So I think that there is that, what I think is much commented on, this implementation gap. And just interesting colleagues' kind of comments and views around that between the rhetoric and the political language and whether they're seeing those priorities reflected in what's coming forward.
Liz?
Exactly the same question, so it's fine.
Oh, the same question, all right, OK. Kirsten?
Just on that issue, I think, of the difference between the rhetoric and the reality. For us, the problem is that the budget makes it almost impossible to tell the difference between the rhetoric and the reality, because there's a real lack of transparency around the third sector, the voluntary sector. So we hear an enormous amount of rhetoric, including this morning, actually, about the importance of the sector around mental health, employability, prevention, all the things that we've discussed as super important this morning. And then within the budget process, there is one line called third sector, which relates to a little bit of infrastructure. And no other way for us to tell how much money comes out of Scottish Government into the sector. There is no overall figure. The Scottish Government doesn't collect it. It's not a box on a spreadsheet in a way that it feels to me really simple that it probably should. So we have no way to really say whether or not the rhetoric around the importance of the sector is brought through in terms of the budget, in terms of that transparency. What we can say is that nothing has been done to help the sector through the budget. We only made one ask for money. It wasn't very much. It was the Barnett consequentials of £100 million that came from Westminster around support for energy. The response was basically, to my mind, that it was never considered. There is none of the narrative about that the previous panel talked about how decisions are made. The answer was just no. And that's a really difficult position to sit in. The other thing that I think is really important when we're talking about the way that budgets are constructed is around the length of time that we're looking at in our horizons here. So the thing that we asked for that doesn't cost any money is to look at multi-year funding for voluntary organisations to give us that sustainability, that understanding that we'll still be here in a year, to not be putting staff at risk of redundancy. The First Minister stood up in November in front of 600 people from the sector and said that we would see it. And then the budget came in December and things had changed. I think that's really a significant miss. I know it's been punted into the long grass in the next event, whatever that is, that we'll be able to talk about it there. But to be honest, I'm not holding my breath because we've been told that before. And I think that's a really significant issue. If we want to be looking at preventative services in particular, if we want to be looking at the voluntary sector's role in public services altogether, then we really have to get those things back on the table.
Okay, Martin, to be followed by Francesca.
Thank you.
Sorry, it's all done for you.
Yeah, so I absolutely agree with Kirsten about the comment about lack of transparency. It's not just in the third and voluntary sector, it's across the entire settlement. We put figures out based on where we were at this time last year rather than where we are at the end of the year. So there's a distortion in the figures. So the headline is that local government's got 5% more in real terms. That's not an accurate comparison. And what it does is it leads people to believe that you've got money that you don't have. So therefore, those decisions become much more difficult. Come back to the comment about focusing on outcomes. One of our biggest individual spend lines in local government is teachers' pay. And we're constrained by teacher numbers. That's an input. It's not an output. It's not an outcome. It's an input. So attainment's improving. A lot of our indicators are really positive, but we're being constrained with how we deliver services by a constraint that is absolutely putting a massive amount of pressure on every other budget line. Multi-year funding would be fantastic, but actually I would be wary of multi-year funding when that's not coming through the entire system. Because if you don't know what's coming from Westminster, for example, then you will be naturally prudent in your assumptions. So actually you might end up with a worse settlement and having to make worse decisions because you're trying to predict forward. But absolutely, it's ridiculous that governments and local authorities are budgeting on a one-year basis. It is a nonsense, but actually the whole system has to move that. Moving a bit of the system actually creates potentially a bigger problem. And actually what we really need is we need an honest conversation about how we deliver public services in Scotland and what's affordable, because we continually increase what we deliver, but we don't fund it, and we don't fund it going forward. So 1140 hours, I don't think anyone would disagree that 1140 hours was a good policy, but actually the funding for 1140 hours hasn't changed since it was first introduced, but the cost of delivering it has gone up quite significantly. Inflation over the last few years has been, you know, I'm old enough to remember inflation at that level, but most people aren't. And that pressure on the system, but you're just it's been thrown over the wall, and it's leading to cuts elsewhere. So we need to have an honest conversation about what we can afford to deliver.
Okay, Francesca to be followed by Jenny.
Thanks very much. I just wanted to return to the theme of rhetoric and reality. I think the previous session, and we're already hearing in this session, has highlighted the really difficult issue around choices in the budget. And there was a question, I can't remember, I think it was yourself, Ross, that asked in the previous panel session, okay, we've heard all the issues, what would you change and what would you prioritise? And I'm not sure I can answer that fully, but what I do see in this budget in terms of rhetoric and reality is a shift to recognising the long-term challenges around climate change. And we've had reference already to those statutory targets on climate change. There will be statutory targets in relation to nature degradation linked to climate change in the future. And I have seen that shift in this budget towards those areas. So from that perspective, I think there is some follow-up in terms of reality in relation to the rhetoric. There is still quite a lot of uncertainties in terms of the budget. We have headline figures. We have headline figures for the environment and forestry area. I have headline figures for my budget, but some of the wider implications, and I think it was yourself, Jamie, who referenced the reduction in other portfolio budgets, which will have an impact. Some of that is still to be worked through. So I think from my perspective, whilst that shift to tackling these very long-term systemic issues around climate change, nature degradation, and how they impact on communities, equality and opportunity is welcome, we've still got quite a long way to go to understanding the full implications across the budget as a whole. Thank you.
Okay, Jenny, to be followed by Michelle.
Around the implementation gap, and then Martin, you raised the point about funding public services, and I suppose let me be thoughtful about how, you know, there's broad consensus that the current model of financing public services is unsustainable, and that something needs to be done, and that something would be to invest upstream. in prevention, as we've heard. And I found it interesting that in the Health Foundation's report last year, No One Left Behind, they reflected on how there's many reasons for implementation gap, but one of the things isn't the lack of managerial understanding, but actually a lack of political consensus. And I suppose it just struck me that, you know, the real strength of an excitement about a committee like this is to build that cross-party and broad kind of consensus and support for this, because it's not just about alleviating pressure on public services, because we need to alleviate pressure, but you're alleviating them because people's lives are better. Mm-hmm. They're living healthier lives. They're able to fulfil their potential and therefore not putting the pressure on public services, if that makes sense.
I actually think there is consensus on the need for prevention. The difficulty is, what do you actually reduce expenditure on now in order that you can put money into prevention? That's when you struggle to actually get people volunteering to say, well, do you know what, we should maybe this segment of our budget shouldn't be spent this year so we can invest it for the future. And that's always been the difficulty. We've been debating this since at least 2011. Michelle, to follow by John.
Been a couple of comments about how we provide best value, and Martin's starting to hit it off, but I'm sure that Richard has a view in terms of the cost of central government and that increase of 30 million where we saw other budgets cut. And obviously you've drawn our attention again to the report about, you know, and the need for workforce planning and so on. So I'd appreciate your thoughts. Were you surprised by that that increase? And what are your reflections on that within the budget in the light of the report you produced at the back end of last year?
Just before you come in, I've actually been threatening to bring Howard in, actually, because one of the interesting points that was in his submission was that since the Scottish Parliament was established, the number of people working in the public sector has grown from 150,000 full-time employees to 245,000, so there's been a huge increase in pay deals agreed between 22-23 and 23-24 were 1.7 billion more than initially planned. So Howard has talked about the need for significant reform of the public sector, including the workforce, to protect services in the long term, and goes on to state that public services in their current shape are not affordable. So that's a number of areas we can go, but if you want to respond to Michelle, Howard, and then we'll see where we'll go from there. Sorry, why did I call you Howard?
I don't know, Richard.
I've been calling Michelle Gillian.
I've been called worse.
I've been calling Michelle Gillian for the last 2 years inexplicably. I just do these things. I do apologise for it. Okay, Richard.
Yeah, anyway. So I mean, there's a few things to unpack there, I think. One, so just on the workforce numbers. So what we're saying is that we would have expected the workforce numbers to increase since the start of the Scottish Parliament, and they have. What it does, though, is bring an additional challenge in terms of the financing of that, given some of the recent pressures in particular, particularly around increases in wages, cost of living, all those types of things. So what we're really looking to sort of promote is the need for reform, because what we're saying, what we find within many of our reports is that what we're not necessarily, when we go and report on a variety of sectors, they tell us that there are capacity concerns. They tell us that there's issues and how that affects how they can deliver services. So a reduction in numbers on its own, and the reduction in costs that may come with that, wouldn't be sufficient to address it. So one of the things that we're really looking to do, and it probably goes to another point, which I may come back to, just about that medium long term lens, is to encourage and ask the Scottish Government to work with the public sector bodies across the piece to say, well, all the bodies are different. To what extent are you reliant on workforce costs and a workforce? What is the extent of reform? What would that look like? What would it mean for services? And that doesn't necessarily have to mean a reduction in quality of services. We give examples of using digitisation, for example, to improve an online experience, which might reduce the number of workforce input required. So I think within all these conversations is about how can we see and monitor the pace of reform. And I think that probably goes back to some of the points that were being made around it only being 1 year, we don't have multi-year budgets. So while the ambitions of the Scottish Government often have a long-term lens around the environment, around poverty, it's difficult to even map out in approximate terms what that might mean in terms of settlements for the various portfolios and how they work together over time. So NSET was raised, I think, as an example of that. How's that going to impact on the economy and the amount of money coming in for budgets? Health, we know that the SFC have done some work on long-term demographic changes and some fairly scary results in what that means for costs of managing health. It would be useful to see some of that and have that factored through also into areas such as workforce and capital was another thing that was mentioned.
Interestingly, digital is an area where there has been a significant increase in the budget going forward. John, to be followed by Shona.
Yes, well, also following up on the multi-year thing, I wanted to follow up what Martin and Kirsten had said about the multi-year funding. I just wonder if we're looking for slightly different things between local authorities and voluntary organisations. Because, I mean, presumably for Glasgow or something, I mean, 5% up or 5% down would make a big difference if you knew that was coming down the route. I mean, to know that you had 50%, as you say, wouldn't be very helpful, presumably. Whereas, I mean, we've raised this before with SCVO, that, you know, even if you knew you were getting 50% or 75% of what you'd had the previous year would make a big difference, because you wouldn't have to make people redundant. Organisations at least would know they would have something. So are we talking about two slightly different things here?
I understand from the voluntary organisation, and you get to December and you have to start giving redundancy notices because you've only got funding up until March, and finding out in February is far too late. Mm-hmm. But actually, if you get multi-year funding where you think you're only going to get 50%, then you're actually making those people redundant, and then the funding comes through eventually. So part of it is if you've got bad settlement or even worse settlements, might be more accurate, because it's based on a projection without having the full detail, you start planning to make bad or difficult decisions, negative decisions, and actually that creates a massive amount of anxiety for staff, for service recipients, for our communities. So it's that, you know, you actually create more stress talking about making a cut almost as much as you do about making the cut. So and this is a very much probably a personal view, that actually having certainty over a budget is I think more important than having that longer term view, although, as I said, it's ridiculous that we're planning, you know, we're setting a budget in February to start in March.
Yeah, we've got another budget coming in March as well, which are UK budgets, so we don't know how that will impact. Shona, to be
can Kirsten come back on?
Oh, sorry, Kirsten, I didn't realise you were going to come back.
No, just to say that, I think the slight difference is that for a voluntary organisation, that might be an existential issue as to whether or not your whole organisation exists. So it might not only be about putting some staff on a redundancy notice. We are now at the point where the closure of services might also mean the closure of an organisation. And so I think that the certainty that we're looking for is not just around individual projects, but that now in some cases translates to the whole organisation. And once the organisation is gone, it's gone, and it can't be readily replaced within that community to provide the support and the connections that are already there and that it has. So I think it's two sides of the same coin in terms of looking for that certainty, but the potential impacts for voluntary organisations can be much greater. I think it also probably speaks to the different funding situations that we find ourselves in, that I find it almost impossible to imagine a time where the amount that's agreed then would go up at the end of that period. I think that would be a lovely situation to be in, but I'd much rather plan for a cut and have that certainty and have that stability, because it's just not the funding environment that we exist in. The other thing, just very quickly about delayed decisions, is that I think the lateness of this budget process means that almost certainly organisations which receive their funding from Scottish Government and also from local authorities are going to be facing those late decisions yet again this year. The Deputy First Minister has, I understand from the Christmas press, said that voluntary organisations who are Scottish Government funded will know that by March, and it would be really good if the committee could help us to keep an eye on that, because little things like that that don't cost any money, those little process issues can make all the difference to voluntary organisations.
I say that when I was first elected in 1999, I was in the Social Justice Committee and we did inquiry into long-term funding for the third sector, so that's more than 20 years ago, and we came to much the same conclusions as you've came to just now, more than 20 years ago, and it's still an issue that's hanging over us. Shona, to be followed by Keir.
Yeah, a couple of points. I would say that the college sector also suffers from short-termism, because we don't have budgets that allow us to plan, and in fact Audit Scotland have addressed that in some reports about, if we had the ability to plan, I think you'd make a lot better decisions. So there's 24 colleges in Scotland, 11,000 staff. that uncertainty that you talked about is massive. And you're trying to run organisations, you're trying to encourage people to come to college and get an education. And it's very difficult when you just don't know if you've got enough money to run that course. Or, you know, we go out in January and start to recruit. We've just had a 5% cut. So that wasn't the point I was going to make, but I would absolutely agree having the ability to plan longer term just means that you run your businesses a lot better, whatever your business is. I wanted to raise a point about the budget. I said we've got a 5% cut, but actually I'm not 100% sure what our budget is right now. We think it's that level. There's ambiguity about exactly the amount of money that the colleges have got to run for next year, because some of the money comes from different budget lines, not just within the portfolio. But even still, that's a level of uncertainty. Colleges are actually charities. So all of our board members are charitable trustees. So, you know, they sit there as independent volunteers on college boards making decisions, and actually they don't know how much resource they're making decisions with. And then if you add to that complexity cash flow, there's a recent report out from the Funding Council last week that has highlighted, because of the cuts that are coming to the tertiary sector, both colleges and universities, but particularly colleges, their cash flow situation is dire. Mm-hmm. We have some colleges who could well run out of cash this academic year, and that's unprecedented. So I suppose what am I asking for? I like the idea of someone saying have an honest conversation, because I think that is missing. I think we should have an honest conversation. If there is limited resources, then let's be honest about what we can deliver, rather than just do this lots of cuts all over the place, because actually it's really, really inefficient, and you won't deliver on priorities because it's like taking the head of everything rather than actually being specific and say what your priorities are. And the college sector are absolutely up for thriving, growing, helping individuals get out of poverty, give them skills, support our businesses. Scotland is full of small businesses. Mm. Skilled workforces come from college students. They are the college, you know, they are the people that will help your businesses run. And if you've got economy running with profitable businesses, everyone benefits. You have your money for your public sector.
I mean, the cut isn't the same across the board, though, because some areas have had quite significant cuts, but other areas like police, fire, and NHS have actually increased. You know,
I know there's priorities.
It's different prioritisations. Keir, to be followed by Michael.
I just wanted to raise a point about reform of the public sector. I think when we talk about reform of the public sector, the conversation can be quite lazy. The public sector has not stood still over the last 10 years. It has been constantly changing, and changing on a shoestring. So, I mean, for us to talk about reform like the public sector has not moved, I think is just really lazy. I think the problems the public sector has around funding is that they're making constant changes, trying to deliver services on a shoestring. And at the moment, they've got the spectre of redundancy, privatisation and bankruptcy hanging over them while they're trying to make those changes.
Challenges in finding a kind of strategic approach around public sector reform. So you're right, Keir, I think it is clear that it's happening everywhere. Every organisation is having to react rather than having a strategic approach. So I just wondered, so we had the permanent secretary and he said he didn't understand wasn't aware what the current government's approach to this was, the status of the resource spending review, and that's been dropped. It seems to be back on the table. Do people have clarity, Audit Scotland maybe in particular, Martin, about where that kind of approach is headed, given what you've heard from the Deputy First Minister?
Well, I think the in terms of what was written to the committee in response to your pre-budget scrutiny, you gave some further information about the stages. I think one of the things it's that strategic approach, isn't it? And it's right, reform happens, but it's how do you capture that and quantify it financially, but also spread it out over time, because some of these reforms may take some time and require some investment. So we talked about digital there. So I think what we'd like to see is good to see this list. We will be inquiring about the detail and the progress of that reform. one of the things I think we've said is about the urgency of it. So the extent to which we can see what the pace of it is, but also a little bit about what exactly we can see in terms of savings or costs in relation to it, because reform isn't always free. It's not as I think Kay was alluding to there. It can cost money to make reform. So how can we see that in the budget in terms of through digital, and then what type of financial return are we going to get for it, or indeed improvement to services?
Yeah, I was a councillor in 95 at the time of the local government reform then, and I remember how expensive that actually was at the time. Stacey.
Thank you. I just wanted to pick up on Shona's point there about that pipeline between colleges and small businesses in terms of employees. We're actually hearing from our members really low levels of engagement, particularly with the apprenticeship system. Just, I think, primarily at the moment because of the cost of doing business, so that might be businesses who want to recruit but they just can't afford to. There's a lot of barriers that we hear from our members in terms of the smallest businesses and apprenticeship, you know, the cost of taking that on, the space and time that is needed to support an apprentice. And then kind of when you get to the end of the apprenticeship, it's often more attractive for the apprentice to then leave and go to a larger company who is able to offer progression, higher wages in that small business. So we are certainly, I think when we surveyed our members this time last year, it was about 80% or more hadn't engaged with the apprenticeship system in Scotland, unfortunately.
Okay, nobody's got their hand up, so I'm going to nab someone and drag them in. Oh, sorry, suddenly all these hands go up when I say nobody's got their hand up. Right, okay. Martin Keir and then Francesca.
To follow on the apprenticeship point, so in local government generally, recruitment is incredibly, incredibly difficult. It's, you know, whether that's social care staff or whether that's professional staff, it is really, really challenging. We can't compete with the private sector for professional staff, and actually our solution has been, so last year in Glasgow we took on 10 trainee accountants, a mixture of apprentices and graduates, and this year we're taking on another 4. Now that's because we had vacancies for qualified staff and we couldn't get them, so we took on additional apprentices. So, and apprentices and graduates are fantastic, but again, keeping them once they qualify is really, really challenging. And again, it's that, have we got the structure right in the public services? The amount of time that we spend dealing with the bureaucracy around, you know, whether that's the relationship with Scottish Government and doing returns. Audit has definitely become more challenging over the last few years. Now we've moved away from Audit Scotland, so I'm not having a go at Audit Scotland. But the amount of resources we have to put in to support an audit, really because of things that have happened elsewhere, where auditors are becoming incredibly risk averse and want to increase their sample size. But we don't have the resources to do that, and it's a real, real challenge as we go forward.
Care to be followed by Francesca?
I just wanted to raise a point around the equality priority in the budget. I think from local government perspective, we are looking at equal pay issues across the public sector. And I mean, with a 5 judgment recently, that many councils are looking at it. Martin ought to be able to tell you a bit about the cost of equal pay. But I think one of the problems we've got is that councils are in fear of taking on and finding resolutions towards equal pay, and taking on the challenge of equal pay because they don't have the finances and the support to be able to resolve that. So I think that's something that we definitely need to consider.
Okay, thanks. Francesca, to be followed by Kirsten.
Yeah, I wanted to come back to the points raised about public service reform, because as we've been talking, and again in the previous session, the conclusion is that we don't have sufficient resource at the moment to deliver all the services that the public sector is delivering and that the public currently expects. And there are a number of ways that you can address that, but one has to be through changing the shape of the public sector and through a reform process. Now, I completely agree with Keir in relation to his points about the ongoing change that we've had throughout the public sector over a number of years, and indeed with Richard about reform is not cost neutral. But I do think we have some opportunities at the moment through the public sector reform programme to make efficiencies. Estates is a key one. If you look at the size of the public service, public sector estate across Scotland, it is large, and the use of that estate has changed significantly post the pandemic in NatureScot, we're changing our profile of our estates to match that. We want to do that in a collaborative way with other organisations, and I think that's the key, is to look at how we can cluster with other organisations so we can deliver those wider efficiencies. Similarly, on digital, great example, how can we use digital services? For example, my organisation provides 3,700 wildlife management licences a year. Now, if we can use digital technology to take out some of the human interactions there, we not only provide a better service for our customers, but we can move people who are doing that at the moment onto other roles. But again, I think a whole system approach. Marine Directorate in the Scottish Government also issue licences, SEPA issue licences, so how are we doing these things collectively? So that collective shift, I think, is really important on public service reform. Thank you.
Thank you, Kirsten.
Just in relation to public service reform, a reminder that not all public services are provided by the public sector, so voluntary organisations do provide a chunk of public services as well as those preventative services that stop people from having to access some of the more mainstream public services. And I suppose to make a link to those issues around recruitment that we are facing in our sector as well, is about sort of thinking about why that public service reform has to be about how we get best value and more bang for our buck rather than only what the lowest possible costs are. So one of the ways sometimes to try and bring the costs down is to contract things out. And sometimes that means that voluntary organisations are given contract values that don't allow them to pay wages the same as their the people in the public service who are doing the same jobs. So not only does that mean that that's a real inequality in terms of the wages that are available to people just dependent on what sector they work in, and then potentially the impact that that has on the service that service users ultimately achieve, it also means that voluntary organisations are sometimes not in a position to meet fair work obligations that obviously we're all trying to get towards. And so just this constant thinking about how can we make it cheaper has these real knock-on effects that include the recruitment challenge that voluntary organisations are facing. That means that those organisations are now sometimes facing issues around their own sustainability. So everything is really systemic, I think, is what I'm saying. And so if we're just thinking about how can we make this thing cheaper, there are ways to do that, but you've got to think about what steps come further down the road. And if those steps are the closure of voluntary organisations, the ending of preventative services, or the loss of those providers to provide public services, potentially at a cheaper cost, but also we saw during COVID, sometimes at a better quality or certainly a different quality, where they can really connect with communities, they can really deliver the things that are needed in those areas, then that would be an enormous loss by looking for those little ways to slice little bits and bobs off the budget here and there.
Okay. So far, everyone's body swerved the issue of taxation. So, Keir, I'm going to ask you about that, seeing as you're the most, yours is the most virulent, I would suggest, submission on that, the GMB's is. So you've said, and I quote on tax, the GMB welcomes the introduction of a new income tax band, as this will collect more money from higher earners. However, it adds that this goes nowhere near far enough to plug the gap in Scotland's finances. So do you believe that the gap should be plugged solely by increases in taxation, or do you believe that there should be a combination of additional grant from the UK, for example, and taxation? How would you pitch it?
I don't see us turning down extra money from Westminster, but I think in Scotland we do have to look at increasing the tax income and increasing the tax base. So I think the STC's document on how that can be done, I mean, that's been talked about, obviously it came up last year and it's been refreshed for this year and it's got lots of ideas in it. I think freezing the council tax, I mean, we've heard a lot about it, we heard about it in the previous session as well. The council tax structure should be changed, we should be looking at a more progressive tax brought in its place. We should be doing more on tax to be able to fund the public services because our communities need those services to be running properly.
Okay, now the SGC was talking about up to £3.7 billion. I mean, the increase in taxation on paper from the Scottish Government is £200 million. But when behavioural change comes into play because of people deciding, well, do you know what, I'm not going to do an extra shift if I've got a marginal rate of tax of 69.5% or whatever, the actual amount brought in is about £82 million. One of my concerns about the STC document was it didn't seem to take into account behavioural change. So what's your view on behavioural change and how that would impact in terms of the, not the amount on paper that you can raise in tax, but the actual amount the Scottish Government would then have to actually spend, given the effect it would have on the behaviour of some people?
I suppose, I'm not an expert on tax behavioural change, but there is also an appetite for people to have public services that are functioning and that are run well. So you can't just be like, oh, I won't take up that extra shift, or I might move to a different part of the country because of the tax rates, when people actually do value their public services to be running and functioning properly, to be able to access NHS services quickly when they need to. So I think it's a question for wider society about how much they're willing to pay for the services they want. But when I talk to GMB members, when I talk to the public service workers and the communities they work in, they want decently run public services. And so that means increasing that tax threshold.
I think they do, but the issue is whether if you increase it to a certain degree, you actually end up bringing in less than if you didn't increase it by that because of the kind of behavioural changes that people make. I mean, so for example, the Scottish Parliament Information Centre and the Fraser Valley Institute and the Scottish Fiscal Commission all said that the 125,140 rate plus would only bring in less than 15% of the money that on paper it should bring in, because people just say, well, do you know what, I'm not going to actually work an extra day this week because it's all going to go in tax anyway. So I'm just asking what the STC is doing in terms, and GMB specifically, in terms of looking at that particular issue, because it's not a kind of, it's not a zero-sum game, you know. It's not a situation whereby you increase tax by 5% and you get that extra money, because you lose money in behavioural change. So I'm just wondering whether the STC and GMB are going to go back and look at that and say, well, do you know what, if we pitch it too high, we end up with getting less, you know, and lower productivity and sluggish economic growth, then we don't have the money for the public services. So I'm just wondering what your views are on that whole behavioural issue.
So I do understand that it's not a zero-sum game, but in the example you give, or whether I do that extra shift or not, well, we can have more permanent jobs and less people having the decision about whether they do an extra shift or not, about whether they whether that's going to push them into a different tax threshold. That's also not a zero-sum game about whether people decide to work out an evening or do a bit of overtime or take on the next job. Someone will. So there is a great understanding that's needed around in that space, but I wouldn't be so negative about it. I think there is, I mean, it may not produce the exact numbers that STC is suggesting. I'm not an expert in that, but I think we still need to explore it. It still needs to be something that's on the agenda, because if we want to fund our public services properly, we need to increase our tax base.
Yes, you can, eh?
Thank you. So I think it's a really interesting bit there around the fact that you raise taxes by X amount, but you only return Y because of behavioural change and all of those things. I think for us there's probably a point there around the extent to which the fiscal lever can be used by the Scottish Government to generate sufficiently more money. So within a budget of £60 billion, the movements, I think is £82
million.
The majority of the changes that have come about through an improved forecast about relative earnings in Scotland and fiscal drag. So I think there's something around the Scottish Government, and I believe that there's plans for an updated tax strategy next year to set out, in the main, because income tax isn't the only game in town, how this is going to manage and what the extent of it is. But I think it leads back to the point that perhaps we've been talking about earlier, which is about the economy, because I think if you look at the three strands of how the Scottish Government intends to manage its fiscal sustainability, part of it is tax policy, part of it is spending, the other part is growing that tax base. So making Scotland an attractive place to work, where wages are driven by, and it goes back to perhaps something like what was being said about skills in universities. So I think it's obviously an incredibly complex area, In terms of the priorities, it's about seeing how the different facets of government are working together to help drive an improved economy, because that will help with the money that's required for the services that Keir mentioned.
Well, earnings growth actually is 6.6%. Scotland's the highest in the UK last year, and that's obviously a lot of that is going to go in paying in, paid in taxes, and also fiscal drag, which both the UK and the Scottish Government are actually implementing, has also brought in huge amounts of money. So it seems that that is bringing in vastly more than the £82 million of the tax increases. I'm just wondering whether the increase in taxation is more ideological than practical, given the fact that these other measures appear to be bringing in, you know, about 20 to 25 times more than the increase in tax rates.
So I wouldn't comment on policy, but I think
what, numbers, not
yeah,
policy.
I mean, the numbers speak for themselves, don't they, in terms of where the additional funds are coming from. I think we've spoken a lot around inter-year and multi-year. We've spoken less about in-year, what may happen quite quickly, and reconciliations, etc. So the SFC do raise about the OBR may change their assessment of what the UK growth position is, and that may factor through into the budget. There's always a number of these factors, so it's about how expenditure is managed in year, especially given the priorities that the Scottish Government have set out.
Mm-hmm. Okay. One of the things that when I said to Keir, I said about additional taxation, additional grant from the UK. Well, the UK grant situation is obviously important. They've cut our capital budget by £484 million. So, I mean, that's going to have a huge impact. And in the previous session, we talked about, for example, the impact on housing, which is facing a 30% cut in the next year ahead. So does the GMB feel that did not feel that the UK government should have increased the grant to Scotland this year?
Sorry, can you rephrase
the grant? So, for example, the resource grant that the UK gives awards Scotland through block grant, do you not think that's something that should have been increased more?
I mean, like as I said previously, I mean, I think we would always be arguing for Westminster to give a greater settlement to Scottish government, so that we can see that to be spent on the services that we want it to be spent on. So, I mean, you won't get a counter argument from myself.
Okay, that's fine. Just for clarification on that. Now, in terms of taxation, does anyone want to comment on taxation at all, for or against? Does anyone want to talk about the capital priorities of the Scottish Government? I've just touched on housing, which was discussed at some length previously, but I'm just wondering if where people think capital can be spent. So, for example, one point I mentioned previously was the police are getting a 12.4% increase in capital, whereas housing is a 30% decrease. So it'll be interesting to see what people have to say about that. Shona?
The college sector has been devoid of capital investment, I would say. We've had capital reviews done that suggest that there's hundreds of millions of pounds required just to make our colleges wind and watertight. And that's not trying to then take into account infrastructure changes or digital improvements or, in fact, meet our net zero commitments. So, the college sector this year had a very, very small amount of capital, which barely covers backlog. So I know we're not the only part of the public sector that's not had that investment, but that doesn't feel like a good enough argument to me. I think our
84 million cut in capital, where should that cut fall?
I can only comment what I think and what the college sector needs. It needs capital investment. We have students who have buildings that have leaks in them with buckets collecting water. Our students deserve a good education, a great experience at college.
Anyone else want to comment on tax, capital allocation, resource prioritisation, any aspect of the budget?
I think just on infrastructure, because we also wrote a report on investing in Scotland's infrastructure. The Auditor General has been calling for quite a while for something more, a public consolidated account to understand better what the extent of the assets are in Scotland. I think that within the report we're saying, particularly because of the need to prioritise a smaller capital budget, they need to be really clear about the extent to which that is going towards maintenance, how it's been prioritised to best fulfil the ambitions of the Scottish Government. And I think another one which the Scottish Government themselves have put forward as a means of reform is shared services and understanding how shared services might affect what's needed in terms of the best use of the assets that we hold in Scotland. So I think there is some work that the Scottish Government is planning next year on understanding better or mapping out how it intends to prioritise its infrastructure, because at the moment what we can say is that it can't afford to do what it originally planned to do.
Okay, Michael.
I think it's a really strong point about the college infrastructure, and I think the contrast we could draw would be with the university sector in that regard, which has the ability to raise its own finance, and of course the Scottish Government has taken an approach over the longer term to draw the college sector much closer to the government and their own regulations and the way that they're run, as resulting in less flexibility about how they raise money. So I suppose it's to come back on your point in that, convener, in terms of I don't think it has to be a zero-sum game in that. I think that there might be alternatives for the college sector to look at different forms of revenue raising and flexibility in the way that they work. And we shouldn't just be looking at saying that that overall capital budget should be cut, because essentially I think this comes down to a class issue where we have, you know, many people who go to colleges from lower working class backgrounds who are receiving a much poorer experience in terms of the physical environments they are than people who more traditional go to university from more affluent backgrounds are in brand new buildings. There's huge investment across the country, or has been over the past decade, which colleges don't replicate. And I think there's a fundamental unfairness in that.
Yeah.
In local government, raising capital isn't the problem, it's paying it back. And I think, without being an expert, the university sector can pay it back because they can bring in overseas students who are bringing revenue in. So raising the capital in local government, we've got prudential borrowing, we can borrow it, it's having the revenue to pay it back, because lots of the infrastructure that we want, that we need to invest in and that we want to invest in, is stuff that is public assets. It's not stuff that generates a return, it's not stuff that generates income. You know, renovating a library, renovating a school, roads infrastructure. You know, we have crumbling roads because of the changes in our climate and the impact that's had having our road surface, but we don't have the capital grant to do that. But, you know, we could borrow for that, but how do we pay it back? Because actually, you know, they're not revenue. We could go into road charging, which is a completely different issue, but it needs to be something like that to make that difference. So it's understanding, it's the where's the revenue coming to pay it back? And that's why universities are very different, I think, from colleges.
The investment in critical safety maintenance and road infrastructure has gone up 40% next year to £524.7 million, and college capital has gone up from £340.7 to £356.9 million, which is 4.5% increase. So both of those areas is actually increase in capital.
And the roads infrastructure, there's a difference between what local authorities control.
Indeed, it's the money that's been. I think the point I'm trying to make is that a lot of the capital, as Ross made in the previous session, is actually going in safety and critical maintenance. It's not actually the amount in actually in road improvements is actually quite low. It's only 124 million. So I think the issue has been that there's been that the trunk road network. Maintenance and safety aspect is such that it's taking the bulk of that capital, and I think that's why local government is not getting the capital that it requires to do the kind of the pavements and the side streets, which are also extremely important for people. You know. Okay. Anyone else want to make any points? Yes, Stacey.
Point just came to me there. I believe there was a cut to the budget for the Scottish National Investment Bank in this budget as well. So our pre-budget submission, and we called for this last year as well, was to look at increasing the investment that SNIB makes with small businesses to encourage that growth. So obviously a cut in the budget for the bank this year kind of gives us a concern in terms of, well, that won't be able, they won't be able to do that if their budget's been cut.
Okay. So I've seen you play your fingers like that, Keir. I keep thinking you're going to ask me something. Are you going to put your hand up to ask something or to make a contribution? Okay then, folks, I don't know. Nobody seems to, there doesn't seem to be any great enthusiasm to ask anything. So if that's the case, we'll... Oh, go on, Shona, hold you go.
Well, actually, you know, during the next phase of the budget, while it still goes through Parliament, you know, is there likely to be much movement in the budgets that have come out at the moment? Because I'd love to see an investment in the college sector.
Yeah, I mean, that's really a matter for bartering and discussion debate between the political parties. I think what you tend to have at this time of year is that the member representatives of each of the political parties will speak to the Deputy First Minister and see if they can shift the budget, the dial on the budget, in one direction or another. But of course, because the budget is essentially, you know, there's not going to be any more money from anywhere, really. Like in the good old days with Derek Mackay's sofa, it's a question of moving it from one page of this to another page. And so if colleges make a really good argument, then it will be no doubt to the detriment of somebody else. That's the way it really works when you've got a budget which is in effect shrinking. I mean, in theory, the theory is, of course, that they use the what's called the GDP deflator. So that means inflation in this budget is 1.7%. We all know inflation isn't 1.7%. But that's how it's measured in terms of this, you know, and it's because it's UK Treasury GDP deflator. The actual reduction there, it's actually, although you look at a 2.6% increase in resources, probably in the real world a reduction because of more than half the money that's actually spent here goes on salaries and wages, and nobody's getting 2.6%.
Kind of transparency in that as well as we go through the budget process, because a lot of the issue comes because the public believe what they read, and they believe that there's a 5% real terms increase in budgets, but it's not comparing like with like, it's comparing the starting position, not the ending position when they look to the next year. And that even for elected members, they don't struggle to understand that. Not that they don't completely trust me when I say, no, that's not what happened, this is what's happening. But it's very difficult for them, and just having more transparency over what the true position is.
Yeah, I mean, local government, just some figures here, is the general capital grant is falling from 607.6 to 476.9 million, which is about 19% reduction. Ross.
Just on that point about transparency, I'm aware of what happens every year, concurrent to the budget process for the following year, roughly, as we start to get reports of the government underspend in the current financial year. So it's kind of a question for Audit Scotland in terms of transparency and public understanding. Do we need to have a different kind of discussion, use different language, present differently when we're talking about underspend? Because we've had, in the past, was it 2 or 3 years ago, there was a £2 billion headline figure for the underspend, the vast majority of which was just a change in how student loans were accounted for. There was no cash that remained unspent at the end of the year. So if we're talking about public understanding and expectations, we constantly have this issue every spring where people think that there's this big pot of money that just hasn't been spent for no particular reason, when actually it's much more complicated than that. Do we need to have a discussion about how we talk about the underspend from each financial year going into the next?
I mean, even say, for example, you had an underspend in paper of 150 million, that's less than one day's revenue for the Scottish Government. I mean, the resource, it's a nonsense. It's the money you have available in order to move things forward. It's always 100% committed, in my understanding. But
at the same time as like public sector pay negotiations are ongoing, it's always, I mean, having sat in some of those discussions, union reps quite reasonably say, well, hold on, the newspapers this morning say you've got £2 billion, but you won't give us £200 million to settle this. Like, well, actually, there's not £2 billion for that.
Yeah, well, newspaper, that's another story. Richard?
It's a fair point, I think, about transparency and what's the best way of understanding it. Each year when the Auditor-General sits in front of the public audit committee, there's a question around the underspend as it is, and your point there, which is about putting that in the context of the overall spending and what that means and how you can carry it forward between reserves. There's another issue when it comes to budgets as well as the spending, which is that the Scottish budget will have money that it can spend plus a lot of non-cash which it can't, and you know, an annual managed expenditure when it can't, but often it's going to be reported as a block, and that can kind of mask some of the under issues around that. So I think it is up for to the Scottish Government to think how they report it. We try to report it as clearly as we can, but it's definitely tricky, as is the issue, I think, that was just raised around budget-to-budget comparison versus actual budget. And I think there is due to be more work coming out around that, But one of the points we've raised in year in terms of workforce, and there were quite, some quite large increases in in-year workforce costs, well, they wouldn't be seen in a budget-to-budget position, but they are real concerns or real costs that local government, NHS and others have to meet.
I mean, I think one of the issues, I'm going to let John in a minute, but one of the issues is the process. So the process, for example, is, you know, we get the autumn statement, you know, we then have 3 weeks for the Scottish Government to produce a budget. What that then has to do is, you know, it has to wait for the Scottish Fiscal Commission to come out with its forecasts, because that's what the budget's based on. They come up with the forecast and say how much is going to be available. They then start divvying up the pot. They have to, obviously, haggle with Ross and his colleagues as well. I mean, you know, because there's obviously a two-party agreement at that stage. And then they have to put this together. Because one of the... So that's the kind of background. Because one of the things I think that, that this budget document lacks, and always lacks, and it's because of what I've just mentioned, I think, to a large extent, is the reasons why these decisions have been made. And I think one of the things in terms of transparency is... I mean, I don't think we can get War and Peace on every budget line, or it would be, you know, more than the 100 and how many pages it is already, 125 pages... but certainly I think it would be useful if we had more of an explanation in the document about why such a decision was being made as opposed to a different decision, and that's maybe something we can press for. Now, time's against us, so after John speaks, I'm wanting people to have a wee think about any final comment any of our guests that they want to make before we wind up the session. John?
Yeah, it was really just to follow on the transparency point. You know, is there a danger we're getting too much information and we're just getting lost in it? I mean, the Spice make the point that just on the issue of inequalities and how the budget tackles inequalities, we've got 157 pages. Now, I confess I have not read 157 pages. So, I mean, I think the convener's kind of touched on it. Maybe it's a different kind of information we're needing. Mr. Booth, Martin?
Yes, it is very complex but a lot of it's the headlines that come out. The public read headlines. They don't read the 157 pages. So if I give an example, going back to last year, where on numerous occasions the Scottish Government quoted their real terms increase in their budget and compared it to a cash increase to local government. So there's a reason why you compare cash to real terms, because if you compare real terms to real terms or cash to cash, you're getting a different narrative. So it's that sort of transparency and openness where you just tell the truth and you compare like with like.
Are they not both true in a sense?
But if you're comparing one, so if you're saying, you know, Scottish Government's had an X real terms increase, but local government's had a Y cash increase, why aren't you comparing like with like?
Yes.
Because so it's about transparency, it's about being honest with the public and honest with all the different sectors as to what the actual position is.
And do you think it's possible for politicians to be honest with the public?
Wouldn't possibly comment, Mr. Mason.
Hey, I will let Jenny in, and then you're definitely the last one, and then we're going to go around the table. And people can volunteer as to who wants to go first. And if you don't, I'll just pick Sunday. So I will say Stacey will go last because we went first. All right, Jenny.
Thank you. Apologies, and this can be by way of my final comment, if that's better for time and speed. And that was just to pick up on the comments around transparency and engaging, whether that's with the sectors or with the public, with citizens. And again, I appreciate this is almost taking a step back to think about that in terms of the budgetary process. But I suppose one thing Carnegie is really interested in is democratic engagement with budget choices, I suppose. And sort of very thoughtful that we did research last year that showed that 60% of people in Scotland feel that they can't influence decisions made that affect them at Scottish Government level, and 51% feel that in relation to local council level, which is, you know, a little alarming in terms of that sense of alienation. The real need to try and reverse that, and is there a way to kind of create opportunities for meaningful participation? Again, this is not a short-term fix, it's not for this time around, but would it be interesting to kind of explore with colleagues kind of ways in which... you know, how could government involve citizens in those broader budget processes or sectors in that, beyond these types of committees or individual tax or spending decisions, I suppose. And that's both as a way to sort of help improve that trust in political processes, but actually that agency is good for people's well-being, and perhaps it could lead to better decision-making because it's informed by sort of what people on the ground are saying, what citizens are saying, what the sector's saying, I suppose. Yes. I'll leave it there. Sorry, I'll let you go.
Right, OK, final comments. Who wants to go first? Or next? Francesca.
Yeah, I'll volunteer to save you picking on someone.
It's going to be you anyway, so well guessed.
Thanks for the invitation. Really helpful discussion. I feel I'm a slight outlier in terms of the people you have before you, because I think in terms of the budget settlement, I see some positives in terms of that pivot towards supporting the nature climate crisis. However, I think some of the generic points that have been made here in relation to budget transparency and early decision making, I would echo. And you know, with regard to voluntary organisations, third sector organisations, and people that we fund, obviously, if we were in a position to have more certainty and more long term or even medium term certainty in terms of the budget position, that would help our relationship with other organisations who are delivering on our behalf. So I would support those comments. Thank you.
Thank you. Martin.
Hey, thanks. And again, thanks for the opportunity to join you today. The LGIU, the Local Government Information Unit, I think that stands for, carried out its first survey in Scotland on local government finances recently, and only one respondent wasn't concerned about the future financial sustainability of their organisation. I think they maybe didn't understand the question. So, you know, all but one were concerned about the future financial sustainability of their local authority. We've seen a pattern of Section 114 notices being issued in England. I don't think that will stop. And we don't have a Section 114 in Scotland, different legislation, but I think the risk of that happening in Scotland is pretty high. And actually, unless we fundamentally review how we deliver public services and look at our structure and look at how we can deliver what's affordable, then I think that's almost an inevitability that we will have that happen in Scotland. And that is really bad for local communities. It's really bad for the most vulnerable people in our society.
Okay, thanks. Shauna.
Investing for growth that helps our economy, giving people a role in society, you know, looking after their well-being, giving them purpose and skills and work, has got to be better in the longer term, because if people don't have hope and work and purpose, you then draw on other services such as health, justice, all sorts, and that's just a drain. So invest and help everybody, help people, help communities, help Scottish economy.
Okay, thank you. Keir?
Thank you. Thanks for the invite to come along today. I would agree with Martin's final points around potential bankruptcy. I would just like to make my final points on public sector pay. There's been a little bit of discussion about public sector pay. Public sector pay hasn't exploded. It's barely kept pace with inflation. And we will not be asking our members to subsidise services with their quality of life. So we will expect decent public sector pay deals for our hard-working public servants.
Thank you. Kirsten?
One of the reasons that I advocate so hard for the sustainability of voluntary organisations is because of the amazing work that they can do, really understanding their communities and then transferring that into campaigning in some senses. And so I will give my last word to some of the other organisations that stand behind me who have commented on the budget. So children's charities, including the Child Poverty Action Group, Action for Children and Save the Children, have all questioned the budget's ability to help meet the child poverty targets, particularly around the Scottish Child Payment. Oxfam Scotland have suggested that short-term budgeting won't resolve the long-term issues that are inherent in Scottish Government's missions. The Poverty Alliance also believe that the budget fails to deliver the fundamental changes that we need to address policy. Shelter Scotland have criticised cuts to the housing budget, and the Coalition of Care and Support Providers in Scotland say that the £12 an hour for social care staff needs to go to 13. So hopefully there are some of the more detailed aspects of the budget settlement that the voluntary sector would like me to influence on their behalf.
Okay, thank you very much. Richard?
I suppose just briefly, the Auditor General has spoken increasingly about financial sustainability and reform, and I think it's likely that that's going to continue over the course of the next year. I think it's been a fascinating conversation about some of the trade-offs, and are there any ideal trade-offs? It doesn't look like it, but understanding the links between perhaps the economy and skills and then the ability to generate taxes, public money. I'd probably just remind that it's a year-round budget process, so I think one of the things that's going to be really important is keeping track of where the overspends and underspends will be on the budget this year as it moves towards that path for medium term, and we'll look forward to seeing what's in the medium term financial plans about how the situation's changed.
Yes, I'm sure we look forward to the spring and autumn revisions. And finally, I think it's you, Stacey.
Thank you. I'll actually circle back to the first question that you made, the first point you made, sorry, about that statement about choosing to invest in health or business. And I think it's important around that when we talk about that kind of can make it sound like if we'd chosen to invest in business, then you're choosing to invest in millionaires. We know that the vast majority of the Scottish economy is small businesses, 99%. So if you actually do invest in those small businesses, you're investing in communities, you're investing in health outcomes, and also a lot of other government policy agendas like community wealth building, I think, is a big one. So it's important not to think of business as a monolith. It's a lot more nuanced than that.
OK, well, thank you very much. I want to thank everyone for their contributions and for coming along today. It's been very helpful. Next week, we will continue our evidence on the Scottish Budget when we hear from the Scottish Parliamentary Corporate Body on its own budget bid and from the Deputy First Minister and Cabinet Secretary for Finance. That being the last item on our agenda, I now close this meeting. Thank you all.